Everybody, welcome to a extra large size of the Ann and After Show, specifically to celebrate the end of 2022. Some of the folks on the show, it's actually New Year's Eve there. For the rest of us, it's New Year's Eve. Is that a thing? I don't know. I'm going to be introducing four extra special guests to come in, and we're all going to talk about our top five shows of the year. But before we get started, I just want to remind everyone to subscribe to this channel. We are on YouTube, we're on Facebook, we're on Twitter. We also have a TikTok account and an Instagram account. So head on over to Anime News Network on any of those platforms. Give us a like, follow, subscribe, you know, like hit that bell. Is that the like motion you do for that? I don't know. All right. So let's just get this underway. I'm going to start introducing our guests. And I think I'll just go from left to right on my screen here. So first, coming from Japan, is Richard Eisenbeis. He's been writing episode reviews for us for a while. I send him to the movie theaters so we can get those early anime movie reviews in. And he's here to join us to talk about his top five of 2020. Hey, Richard.
Hey.
How are you doing?
Oh, just doing great. Getting ready for New Year's Eve tonight.
Yeah. Do you got any special plans? Are you going to Shibuya or something?
Oh, God, no. No, I'm way too old for that. I'm just going to watch some of the, I'm going to watch Ado sing tonight on Japanese TV.
Oh, on the Red and White, right?
Right. Yep. She's doing her set from One Piece film Red. So I'm going to watch that.
Oh, nice. That made it onto our movies list, although that's not going to be published on ANN for a couple days. So spoilers, guys, someone put that on their list. I wonder who it was.
I wonder indeed.
Right. All right, joining me and Richard is Caitlin Moore from Anime Feminist and also reviewer over at Anime News Network. And she has some pretty spiffy hair, I just would like to say. Yeah.
Thank you.
How are you doing, Caitlin?
I think I'm mostly over this cold. Hopefully my voice will last for this entire recording. And if not, well, I know the sign language alphabet. Finger spell everything. Oh.
Hopefully at least one other of us here can also interpret for you, because it's been, I learned that in like first grade and it's a little rusty. That and Silent Night. I can still do some of Silent Night in
I can sing the first few bars of Silent Night in Japanese that I learned in first grade.
All right. So between the two of us is like three languages for this one very particular Christmas song. All right. You've seen James two times already this week, but we can never say no to another appearance from James Beckett. So here's James also joining us with his top five.
Yeah, I'm back. It almost feels like I've forgotten what life is like outside of the stream.
He actually just lives in my computer.
I live in this corner of the screen at all times. I don't exist when the stream gets shut down.
James is a VTuber that I created for News Network. He's very light.
Surprise. Yeah. We wanted to see what would happen if you took all of the cutest and most like visually appealing aspects of VTubers, but did the opposite of that.
Oh, science. I didn't know where you were going with that. I was going to say James is horrible. What are you talking about? All right, joining, filling out our pentacle of reviewers here is MrAJCosplay from the Cartoon Cypher, reviewer extraordinaire. Hey, AJ, good to have you back. It's been a little while.
Yes, it has. I'm the demon that you summoned with this pentagram, so it all works out.
But what did we have to exchange in order to get you? What was the cost? That's the question.
My closing parenthesis.
There we go. But yeah, it's happy to be back.
It's just really, I know what you're, why is it gone, Caitlin? Where is it?
I forgot to put it in.
I think you can hit the settings edit button and put it in there, or we can just roll with it, whatever you want to do.
You know, I'll just roll with it, because if I put it in, we may lose AJ, so.
Yeah, that's true. Well, it could be, you could be like poor James, where our overlay is eating into his, eating his name there. Yeah, so it's just James. after that point.
He's James Beck.
Yeah, James Beck.
No, my, my full legal name is James Beck Anime News Network. That's why we actually all first met, because I had to sue, because I was honestly a little concerned about the site using most of
your likeness.
Yeah, it was a little offensive, but we eventually worked out a deal. So.
Okay. So for the format, I haven't hosted one of these in a while. I was on one with a close friend of mine about 2 years ago. And so the format is going to kind of mimic that. But if you haven't ever listened or watched one of these before, the idea is we're going to do round robin style, counting down our top five anime of 2022. If there are repeats, the person who has it on their list, like later at a later number, will chime in then. So we're not going to reiterate each time. And then at the end, hopefully, if you're here in the comments, you can give us your top five. And it'll be wrong, but we'll let you do it.
So, unless it exactly matches one of ours, then it's right.
Yeah. You can put them in a different order, but it's got to have like the same shows. So.
I disagree. You cannot put them in a different order.
Anyway, all the sassiness is a joke. I always like to point that out because some people take it seriously. But Jeeves is like, I take it seriously.
I wasn't going to say anything, but.
But I'd also recommend, if you guys haven't already, maybe I should have told all of you before I introduced you, you know, maybe have some water or something. I think we'll probably be here for at least 2 hours. Caitlin's like, I gotta go.
Oh boy.
If we have to do an intermission, we can do that. This is my third podcast of the week, so I really don't care about any of the rules anymore. I'm just doing whatever I want.
You've reached your breaking point.
I have. I have worked so much this week. I just don't. This is just to have fun. So without further ado, we're gonna get started. Number five. I was going to go clockwise, but not me first. So I'm going to pull up Richard's number five. Yes, I have it. Yes. Okay. Jackie's not here, so she can't disagree with you
this time.
So I think some of you guys might already know what this is. But Richard, your number five is Birdie Wing. Would you like to tell us why?
I'm a fan of like what we would call over the top anime. I like things that are ridiculously over the top, stuff like Kakegurui, stuff like Kill la Kill, stuff like that, where it's just way, way over. And honestly, what really got me about Birdie Wing is I don't know everybody's ages, but well, when I was a kid, in the ancient time of the 90s, there was this Kevin Costner movie called Ten Cup. Okay. And it's not a great movie, but there's a scene in it where he plays a round of betting golf using only a hoe, a shovel, a baseball bat, and a rake. Okay. And it is one of the funniest scenes like I had ever seen as a kid. And it's the exact same energy. It's like somebody saw that movie and then went, yeah, I could do that, but make it an anime and go way farther over the top. And I was never bored. I loved it. From start to finish, I loved the Yuri aspect, the star-crossed lovers kind of tale that they have, the rich girl, the poor girl, and like the idea that they're both like bored with their lives, even though they're so great at golf, until they meet each other, and then they actually find meaning in life and in golf after they meet each other, and they become the driving force in each other's lives to be better.
Driving force.
Yeah. Pun intended. Hey!
First pun of the night. There will be more.
They will not stop.
Yep. But
did anyone else put Birdie Wing on their list, Caitlin? All right.
It was my number five too.
Oh, okay. All right. What did you do to put Birdie Wing on there?
So you know, I'm gonna give the same spiel that I give like every time I talk about it, which is that I have had such a hard time finding girls' sports anime that I have enjoyed. Either they're about cuteness, or they're about titties, or they're about something else that, or I mean, people always say, but Hanebato. I'm like, yeah, but I just didn't vibe with Hanebato. Or like, you know, Farewell, My Dear Kramer, the animation was garbage. Just, yeah, it looked terrible. And so for, you know, I've been just like, I just want that one girl sports anime where they take it seriously, but not too seriously, the highs and lows. And then Birdie Wing came along and I'm just like, oh, actually, forget all of that. This is what I wanted. Ridiculous, over the top, not just there for cuteness or titillation, but also doesn't take it seriously. And I never thought that series that was going to give me what I was looking for would be golf, because my dad watched golf when I was growing up. Every weekend morning, Dad, can I please watch anything else? Because this was also back before everyone had their own computers. It's like, no, I want to watch the golf. And it felt like it went on for all day.
You could watch
Saturday
morning cartoons because your dad is watching golf.
Yes! And this was before Netflix, and this was before DVR. Yeah. You know, because I'm dating myself here. And
it's okay. Caitlin and I are the same age.
It's true. We're like 6 weeks apart.
Yeah.
But I just was... You never knew what was going to happen next because it was all so completely and totally ridiculous. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to spoil it too much for the people who are going to watch. So I'm not going to name the big ending twist that had everyone hooting and hollering. But like, you know, in the first episode, they're playing on a rail yard, like with someone's got a clown mask on. It's completely, completely over the top. And we look, bye, Richard.
He's back.
Richard wouldn't.
I'm back.
And yeah, no, it was just so much fun all the time. Super engaging. I love Eve and Aoi. I was very alarmed to learn that they are actually 15. Cause it's like, oh man, I thought Eve was hot.
I mean, that's just like the horrible, awful, like, anime reality where every teenager acts like they're in their, like, mid to late 20s, and so you don't want to, like, have to ask how old they are, and then when a show tells you, you're like, damn it, why couldn't you have just let me have this one? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, it feels so rare that an anime is just, like, fun and ridiculous, but also, like, not just throwing boobs in your face all the time. Like, Richard, you mentioned, like, you like over-the-top series like Kill la Kill. It's like, and I mean, I like Kill la Kill, but I'll sometimes it's like, y'all,
oh, yeah,
like,
it's back off with the, like...
So yeah, no, Birdie Wing gave me something that I didn't know that I wanted, but I desperately did.
Well, because, no, and I've also, like, wanted, like, that good girl sports anime, and the last one I think I watched it even slightly scratched an itch was like Princess Nine back in the early 2000s, which is about a group of girls who form a baseball team and want to go against the guys.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a high school thing like that.
I hear that one mentioned a lot, but people are really angry about the ending.
Yes. Yes, and they should be.
So, oh,
AJ or James, do either of you have anything to add about Birdie Wing? It didn't make, I think, James, did it make your list?
It got really close. For a while there, it was kind of neck and neck with another gloriously over-the-top anime about badass women that I'm sure we're going to end up talking about.
Yeah, we're
going to
talk about that. Yeah.
But I think the reason it ended up not quite landing in my top five is because it is so over the top and such a kind of just such a comedy that it didn't have as much of like an emotional impact as some of the other shows that came out this year. And so it's funny, Richard, you compared this to, what was it? 10 cups, 10
cup,
Tin Cup. The comparison that I always think of when I think of Birdie Wing, and I've actually described it to my friends this way, is it's like if a Happy Gilmore were a cartoon and really gay in the best ways.
Yeah,
and sure. I think just like an Adam Sandler movie, you know, a good one back when he was in the long ago days of the late 90s and early 2000s. It's really funny and it's really amusing and it's really entertaining and it's hella quotable. But I don't think, I guess we'll see maybe where this next season is goes.
Yeah, it's going to get a second season in April, I think, right? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think especially, you know, the relationship between the two main characters, you know, wherever that ends up going, if it ends up being satisfying or not satisfying, I could definitely see it maybe like sneaking up in the 2023 list. But it just barely missed out on my top five just because it's really funny. It's really entertaining. It's, I think it's cool as hell. Fight me, Jackie. But yeah, just not quite as good as some of the other shows that came out for me.
I haven't watched it.
Me neither. That's very sad.
Yeah, but I plan to rectify that because I think it's something I could also watch with my husband that he'd really like. For our next number five, I'm gonna go to AJ, because AJ's got a unique one here. It's not on anyone else's list.
Well, because I cheated.
Shame. He kind of cheated, but I told him it was okay. All right. Yeah. So he's got Pokemon Journeys, the series, as his number five. AJ, let's get emotional, and you could tell us about how this series means so much to you and its conclusion for this year.
Okay, so this year sucked in like a lot of ways. and there were a lot of good shows this year. I'm just surprised that I'm sitting here saying, yeah, I liked the end of Pokemon.
Yeah.
Because I never thought that day would like come in my lifetime. And we'll get like more like the next with like a new character and everything. But this is like the end of my childhood. In a lot of ways, more so than like Naruto was and everything. Like, this was the first for me and a lot of people. So when this scene happened, I was in a call with my friend and we like nearly cried together. Aww. So it was, yeah, it's a little cheating. It technically ended 22. And with all of the great shows that came out this year, I had to go by what show made me feel something like more than the others. And again, kind of cheating, but it's for a good reason. I don't think this will ever be on a list again. So why not put it here now?
That's a good point. That's a good point.
I was going to say, I mean, we're literally, I mean, I guess we can't say for sure. Who knows if they'll try to pull like a reboot in a couple of years, but in theory, this is the only time we'll ever get to talk about Ash winning, you know, I mean, everything. Being the best, you know,
yeah.
Like
yeah.
No one ever was. So,
yeah.
And they could have copped out at like the very last minute. I legitimately had no idea what was going to happen until the very, very end.
Well, because I mean, that's the thing. How many years? It wasn't like it was decades before he won his first like league.
Yeah.
Right. Like he lost
last season. Last region is when he first won.
Yeah, and I mean, he's just been such a perpetual loser, but like in a good way.
Yeah.
Well, because that's the thing. Like that, I was shocked because you know I had watched it when I was young, and then you know I drifted off of it, and it literally shocked me when they're like, "Oh, he finally won," and I was like, "Wow, wow!" Yeah. That took a while.
Yeah. And it's like it'd be like if like the Simpsons moved away from Springfield or something. You know, it's like a, I mean, it's Ash not being the champion.
But, yeah.
Yeah, like now, because since I'm out of the Pokemon loop, did anyone know this was going to happen? Was there like rumors or like was it announced or was it truly like they just pulled it out of nowhere?
It was truly kind of kept in the dark because, and this is kind of like a bad thing, but this was the past 6 months, I would say. We know all those lovely production issues that plague the anime industry. This was the first time it got really bad for Pokemon.
Oh, okay.
Like they had to, in between episodes, they would like skip 1 or 2 weeks at a time. Sometimes.
You know, that's funny you say that because I noticed that. I didn't know the reason behind it, but okay, I'm a dork. So I was on the anime encyclopedia or A&N encyclopedia page for Pokemon Journey specifically because all the announcements that come out about, you know, they're going to do that 11 episode wrap up for Ash and they're going to have the new season. And Netflix has like made sub seasons out of what is a singular season in Japan. And I was trying to figure out like what episode does Journeys become Master Journeys become? Is it Ultra Journeys? I might even have those in the wrong order, but I was trying to figure out, you know, at what episode that happens. And that led me to going to the Japanese TV Tokyo website for Pokemon and just deciding to input all the air dates for every episode so far, because I enjoy data. And so while doing that, I went through several pages of the episodes. And I was like, wow, they keep skipping like 2 weeks or a couple weeks here or there. And it's not a holiday situation. And yeah, I noticed that they had been skipping episodes for several weeks at a time and was...
It was because of animation issues. There was an animator on Twitter who mm-hmm. came out and basically said, we have no idea what's happening after this because oh, wow. we're just literally going 1 week at a time. And there was no announcement of a Scarlet and Violet thing mm-hmm. because usually they would announce the follow-up season around the time that one would end. So it's like, no one knew what was going to happen. Like,
yeah.
Even if he won, we figure no one thought that like this would be the legitimate end of Ash.
Yeah.
Even if he won, it's like, oh, he can just kind of keep going. But nobody wanted, even if he lost, he would still be like the second best trainer in the world. So it's like, where do you go from mm-hmm. where do you go from here? That's yeah. where a lot of the big questions and, were.
Yeah, you know, I haven't really engaged with the Pokemon anime for a long time, but AJ, I don't think you're the only one on the internet who's going to have this in their top five list. My friend D over at Anime Feminist, she's been super into Pokemon, like without cessation.
Oh, she's got a long Twitter thread up for her watch along, right? Yeah.
Yeah, no. And so like she was just like super emotional over it. But yeah, you know, I mean, if it weren't for Pokemon, I wouldn't be sitting here with all y'all. Like,
yeah,
this, like, even though I haven't watched it for a long time, like, I feel it as the end of an era.
Yeah, I watched the initial, like, Indigo League with my brother when we were little. Like, mm-hmm. he was into the trading card game, and we both played, you know, Red and Blue. And so we watched the anime together on Kids WB. So, I mean, yeah, it's been like a, I mean, my youngest is six. He knows who Pikachu is. So it's mm-hmm. it's been like oh, yeah. a foundational thing for generations at this point. And
oh, yeah. No, the kids these days, you know, I work with kindergartners. They love Pokemon. You know? Yeah. It's still, I do think that it kind of faded for a little bit, but then it did come back.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, it's,
you know, it's so funny.
It's wild to think that Ash's journey is over.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of the kids, I was talking with the students in my anime club, and this is a couple years ago now because we had to shut down anime club on account of everyone's favorite worldwide pandemic. But before that happened, they were getting into this argument about like, what are like the best and worst animes and blah, blah, blah. And they, you know, they mentioned a couple of shows that I can't remember at this point, but at one point I said, I'm surprised none of you guys have mentioned Pokemon, because I've seen you guys, like, you bring your Switches in and you play it all the time. And every single one of them, and these are like self-proclaimed weebs, right? Like, they're watching My Hero Academia. You know, they're wearing anime shirts to school. They're in anime club. They did not think of Pokemon as an anime. Like, they truly were like, that's not an anime. What are you talking about? It's like
it's like Mickey Mouse. It's, you know, it's
yeah, just, no, but like
it's so ubiquitous in like the cultural right. zeitgeist. Yeah. You don't mm-hmm. register it as something like foreign. And for
exactly. that's kind of by design.
Pokemon has like tried to be more global since I want to say Diamond and Pearl.
Yeah.
So much so that like they don't have Japanese language in the show anymore to make it easier to localize. But yeah, Pokemon isn't just a Japanese thing anymore, I would say. Even the games get released worldwide. There's mm-hmm. no like special separation or anything. And it's crazy because we do have these big shows, some of which we'll talk about here, that are able to reach people all over the world. You could argue Pokemon was one of the first to like truly globally touch everybody.
I'd say probably
I think that's probably fair. It's, like, yeah. Because yeah. like a couple before. You could maybe like line up with it pretty close, yeah. but it's definitely one of them for sure. Yeah.
So yeah, it's not perfect. Like even looking back as I am rewatching some of those early seasons for like reviews and stuff, and I'm like, the fact that the season kind of sets itself up as a celebration, like you bring a lot of old characters back, you get some payoff for things that happen like in Hoenn and Sinnoh, and I feel validated as someone who has watched not all of it, but most of it up until this point. But now that it's over, it's like, well, they could have paid that off better. They could have maybe added this, but given the production issues, I wonder if they even knew they were going to end it up until like maybe the last couple of months. So
yeah.
Well, maybe that's what that 11 episode run will be, is like their chance to really go back and tie up all those loose ends.
Yeah. That would be nice. I can't wait to watch that.
Yeah. All right. The next one, this is technically James and my number five. We picked the same, although I kind of cheated. I put two for my number five because the issues with my
scandal.
Yeah, I know. That's one of the perks of being the executive editor, is you get a bonus number five. But this is Attack on Titan, the final season, part two. Still a really dumb name.
Yep. Thanks, Peppa.
James, would you like to talk about why did one of the biggest franchises in anime in the last 10 years only make it to number five for you? And then I'll probably just agree with everything you say. So go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, so it's one of those things where when I was making my list, I kind of knew that this would kind of have to be on there.
Yeah.
I can literally maybe name only four other shows that I've thought about as much, written about as much, talked about as much, enjoyed talking about as much. Right. I think when it comes to why it's number five, as a lot of people have said, this year was insanely stacked. Yeah. Like truly, I think in almost any other year I've been doing this, this would have been like a top two or top three show, hands down. And so the fact that it got edged out to the very end of the list, I think really speaks more to how incredible this year has been. But I will say that making this year's list was so difficult that at a certain point I did end up going back to my reviews and just like tallying up the stars that I gave it, just to be like, what won mathematically? That didn't determine anything, but it at least helped me like.
That's really funny because we have other daily streaming reviewers who intentionally put garbage numbers in there because they care so little about, not garbage, like they rate it poorly. But if Nicholas Dupree was here,
he's rated animated GIF.
He's done animated GIFs, but also he's been open about the fact that he finds the number system kind of like not as meaningful as the content of the review. And so for his star reviews, he usually puts like 8 decimal points after the number.
I know, I've noticed that. Yeah.
I haven't yet had to stop, but yeah. It's on my to-do list because it's dumb. But anyway,
I agree.
That's the point.
I mean, yeah, if we're truly going by star ratings, technically, I can't believe I'm saying this, but The Fruit of Evolution would win because I'm pretty sure at one point one of those episodes had like a million stars. But then I think it lost all of them. I can't remember. I
run a really tight ship here. Yeah.
Nick Lost Thief is the king of malicious compliance.
Yeah.
But no, the star numbers didn't really affect my placing of it, but it helped me at least kind of, because this is one of the shows that aired right at the beginning of the year, it helped me kind of put my head back into some of the ups and downs. And I think that this, because it is the final season part two, I think if anything, the season suffered from like the middle entry in a trilogy syndrome, where there was a lot of setup and a lot of like getting Aaron to where he needs to be for the final arc to happen. A lot of getting the Marleyans and the Paradisans on the same page as far as like who they're fighting for, why they're fighting. And while it's all really interesting and really compelling and really good, that's why it made number five on the list. A lot of it is also stuff that I know isn't truly going to pay off until whenever the hell we get the final season part three. Hopefully before like next December. We'll see. But still, it's Attack on Titan, man. Like, I know that it's been controversy to death and people have take after take after take, and I get it. Like, I get the the problems people have with it. I get how messy it can be. I get how iffy some of its at least appropriation of political imagery can be. But I don't think I've ever seen, at least not from this decade or this generation, with a couple of exceptions, any anime truly capture like what war probably feels like better than this show. I mean, it's a horror, you know, it's a horror story as much as it is a war epic. And I just love the way that it's been able to get me invested in this world and invested in these characters and frightened of them just as much as I am frightened for them. And that's such a hard thing to do that I, you know, there was never any chance that this wasn't going to be on my list.
Yeah. It's kind of funny because I had almost completely forgotten about it. And I don't think this was the strongest season of Attack on Titan, but I will say, like, basically, like going off of what you were saying, like that scene on the dock where they're, you know, where they're trying to con their way to the seaplane, is one of the tensest, saddest, just most viscerally painful scenes. Because it could go so many different ways, but almost all of them are going to be bad. And you know that.
Yes.
And so I put Attack on Titan as my number five along with Maiden Abyss. I'll save my Maiden Abyss to when it comes up for a little later in the show. But for me, this season of Attack on Titan didn't quite edge out ahead of past seasons. One is because of the color design. I think part of the switch to MAPPA, it has gotten really brown. Like really brown, like sepia kind of for a lot of it. The other is that I'm stupid when it comes to time travel stuff. So when you start like introducing like complicated time travel mechanics, usually my brain starts like turning into pretzels and it's like I start thinking about it too much and it's hard for me to keep track of. So you could say that like I didn't put it that high up because I didn't understand Attack on Titan, which if you want to accuse me of that, whatever, go ahead. But I just thought that some of the mechanics that they introduced in order to justify some of the actions and some that the characters took was convoluted in a way that I didn't really like. And I don't know, Aaron sucks. So it's just why it made it to my number five is because I did enjoy talking about it a lot on the after show with James and Jackie. So, I mean, it was still more interesting than a lot of things that I watched because it generated a lot of discussion. But, you know, I also have some trepidation going into part three. I got to interview Hajime Isayama this year. He feels real bad about the ending. People have been pretty awful to him about it, but he also feels kind of bad about it, which makes me worried that I'm not going to like it. I have come around a little bit on easing up some of my criticism for its use of historical allegory, even though I don't think it was done with the correct amount of sensitivity or consideration. And most of that does come from talking to Isayama and getting to, like, listen to him talk about how he came up with everything at Anime NYC this year. So I don't know, maybe I'm like making a character judgment about the creator without all the information, but I just get the sense that it wasn't malicious. So that all of that considered, yes, I'm definitely going to watch Attack on Titan until there is no more Attack on Titan, even if I hate it in the end, but dang it, it makes for good discussion. It really does. AJ, did you have anything you wanted to add about Attack on Titan?
I did not finish this particular season, not because I didn't want to, but because life got in the way for a lot of reasons. Like I said, it's been a very hectic year, but I think James kind of summed up how I feel about the show that I've been trying to put into words for like the longest time, because like you, Lynzee, I don't agree with a lot of like the kind of nationalist allegories and some of the things that like the dark shift that some characters have taken, but I also get it when you consider how badly war can change you as a person. It's less about winning and more about getting back and just finding as much justification for your horrible actions as possible. And then I look outside my window and look at the world, and I'm like, oh, okay. That's, I think even if you disagree with what it might be trying to say, I think it is the fact that it gets people talking to this degree, I think, is a good thing. So yeah, that's as much as I can say right now. I'm waiting until we at least get an announcement for the final part of the final season. I can't believe I have to say it like that.
Yeah.
Before I I might just marathon the final season altogether, or
probably not a bad idea.
Yeah, that probably make for a better experience.
There's so much stuff that happens in every single episode. Yeah. I feel like I have to take notes.
Yeah. James probably did take notes.
Oh God. Yeah. Especially the minute that time travel stuff started happening, I was like, oh Jesus, how am I going to recap this? Going to the wiki and what's happening? Yeah.
Yeah. It's all a right. lot.
Is everyone ready to move on to number four?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. All right. This is Richard's number four.
Oh, yeah.
Richard, I don't know why you chose this picture in particular, but your number four is Uncle from Another World.
You really wonder why I picked that picture?
Because you wanted that reaction.
I don't like looking at that. I'm screening it through my hair right now.
Well, if it makes you feel any better, it's because he got to hear a Sega song for the first time in years. Oh, and that's why he's so happy.
Okay.
Legitimately, I get that, actually.
What kind of Sega song are we talking? Are we talking
No, it's literally what was it? Starlight Zone from Sonic the Hedgehog.
Oh, okay. Oh, well, that's understandable reaction.
Yeah, that's
a
good
one. That is fair. I feel Uncle from Another World has been really screwed over by the Netflix release schedule.
I still don't know when I can publish the rest of your reviews.
Yeah. Because I've been watching week for week here in Japan, and I've absolutely been loving it, obviously, since it's on this list. But basically, I know we get, anime gets a lot of flack for it's like, oh, everything is isekai now, right? Or whatever like that. But, that's kind of a thing about art in general, is the best art comes not from complete freedom, but from having a framework and then making something new out of an established framework. Like this one, really, the framework is what happens after your isekai adventure is over, when you're 15 years out of time, coming back to a new world, or coming back to a world that's like the one you left, but also completely different. And it's about basically reverse culture shock, as this guy is having to adjust to not only being back in the real world, but having magical powers in the real world.
I didn't know he got magical powers in the real world too when he came back.
Yeah, yep. Oh, he keeps all of his powers, which is an interesting thing. Yeah, and it's basically two stories in one. We're getting the story of him back in our world and basically becoming a YouTuber using his magical powers to make it do weird camera tricks that totally couldn't have happened without CG, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the same time, he uses memory magic to show his nephew and his nephew's best friend his adventures in the other world. And they're both really good stories with really good characters. But the thing is that his interpretation of his own memories and the actual memories themselves aren't reliable.
Oh, he's an unreliable narrator as well?
Well, the memories we see are objectively true, but the problem is he has terrible social IQ.
Oh, okay.
There's a big joke where one of the characters, the female elf that he keeps encountering, is a tsundere. And he fundamentally does not understand that concept, to the point that when his nephew asks him, wait, did you watch Evangelion? And he's like, oh, yeah. Did you know that Asuka actually liked Kaji? And that's the max level he can understand romantic relationships.
Oh, okay.
So he can't understand that kind of stuff. So he has terrible social IQ. And then the other problem is such horrible crap happens to him in the isekai world that he was constantly using memory magic to erase his own memories and the memories of the people around him. So he is an unreliable narrator for bad social IQ and the fact that he's cut out large chunks of his own memory.
Weird. Okay.
And but the thing is, by rewatching it, since it's the magic is giving him an objective view of his past, he's slowly starting to remember that things weren't quite as what he thought they were.
Oh. Okay.
And
there's
so it's
way
kind
more
of
going
this
on in this show than I thought.
Yeah, I thought there was a lot of Sega. I thought it was mostly Sega.
Oh, and it is. Like a lot of it, that's kind of the joke. It's like a lot of 90s jokes and humor about the console wars. Like the first, we're introduced to his memory eraser magic because the first thing he does when he wakes up back in our world is ask who won the console war,
right?
Sega or Nintendo. And his nephew says Sega, or he says Sega's not making consoles anymore. That's how bad they lost. And then he just goes and he writes down what memory he's going to erase in a little notebook. And then he erases the memory.
Because he doesn't want to know that Sega doesn't.
It's because it's so emotionally damaging to him that he can't possibly retain that information and stay sane. Like, and so it's a kind of a dark comedy, silly comedy, but it's also like got a really good, like solid mystery at its core, which is, like, he thinks that in the fantasy world he had no friends and was totally alone. And yet we see slowly but surely the exact opposite. Mm. So why did he think that is kind of the question that keeps coming up. So, yeah, so it's a lot of fun.
For Uncle Netherworld, I don't think anyone else put it on their list, but did anyone else here watch it?
No.
No?
I might have to now.
Yeah.
Yeah, no kidding. Like, this is...
Oh, yeah,
sold me on
it's really good, but like, yeah, I mean, like I said, I think it really got messed up by the Netflix where it was being simulcast week by week, 2 weeks behind Japan, and then the delay
delayed,
happened,
right?
And, yeah. And fine, whatever. But then it started up again in Japan and didn't start up again in America. So, I mean,
so
right,
only half, like, the show is available in English.
Are they just
right now
waiting for the second half to finish completely, or?
I've never seen any official announcement.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Thanks, so, Netflix.
Yeah.
So yeah, it but when it, you know, when it's fully watchable, I mean, yeah, this is what it is, you know.
Yeah.
Especially if you're a 90s kid like me, and you know, you remember like the Sega stuff, like it's a ride. And they got all the rights to it. So it's not like they'll show Sonic the Hedgehog, they'll show Altered Beast. They won't just have
kind
a fake
like
that's a deep cut.
Yeah, Altered Beast girl, like queues up a lost memory in the back of my head of because I had Nintendo as a kid. I had a super SNES, and then a friend of mine, he's in between my brother and I in age. When we would go over to his house a lot, his dad worked with my dad. And they had a Sega Genesis. So when you say like Altered Beast, that was a game we played on the Sega Genesis, but it's like specifically associated with going to my friend Tyler's house and playing Sonic and playing Altered Beast. And how does that sound effect go when you transform?
Can you rise from your
rise from your grave.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's there's actually a joke literally about that in the thing, because he thinks it means like champions go forth and fight.
Uh-huh.
And then like they bring out Siri and do like Google Translate, and it's like, wait, rise from your grave? That's so scary. Why would they say that? You know,
so funny.
So yeah, jokes like that.
All right, our next number four, AJ, we're coming back to you, and you picked the show that you have some personal experience with. It's
Right,
My Dress Up Darling. Did you forget?
I forgot like what place everything was in. For some reason, okay. I thought my number three pick was next. But yeah, how could I forget this show? Because nobody let me forget this show when I was reviewing it at the beginning of the year. People are mean.
Oh, were people about the show? Did I forget that people?
No,
were
the
mean
show
about
is
it?
Great, but like
people got vicious over this one.
Yeah.
Oh, about Marin, right?
I had a friend who like made like a who was a cosplayer who liked the show, who made a very mild comment like, "Hey guys, maybe don't darken your skin for cosplay because like
that
kind of makes
it,
a black
I remember
face." People were making tweets, like making fake tweets of them saying the N word.
Yes, I remember that. That was my friend.
My friend too.
Oh wow! Yeah, well, I saw that happen, and then I tried commenting on it and got dogged on. And then I went to the forums on ANN when this episode came out, both prior to and when I wrote the review for it. And I got dogpiled. I think it's the only show I've reviewed so far that has like triple digit comments in the forums. And more than half of them are probably dealing with that thing. So why is this in my top five? Aside from that,
aside from a toxic fan base, yeah.
Well, it stems from a bunch of other things. As the, I guess, resident cosplayer sort of on the team.
And you don't say sort of. Haven't you been like paid to be in costume at events?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. You've earned the title.
Okay. Well, I'm not the only one that cosplays here. But there is a lot of like infighting that goes on in the cosplay community, and some of that does come down to different goals that different cosplayers might have, and sometimes it is very regional. I like this show because it's a very funny, well animated romantic comedy, and I love the characters and their dynamic. But I also think it is a very good 101 introduction to if you're curious about cosplay and don't mind fan service, because yes, there is a lot of it, and I'll excuse some of it because it does the awkward boy POV thing. Other times it clearly doesn't. But it gets difficult sometimes because the show tries to propagate this idea that accuracy in your cosplay above everything else, like do whatever you can to look almost exactly like the character, darken your skin, change your eye shape, modify your bone structure and everything. That is a very Eastern mentality in cosplay. You won't find a lot of people over here in the West that share that mentality. So that's why sometimes, even before the controversial dark skin episode came out, there were a lot of people that were using this show as, see, this is how cosplay is supposed to be.
Oh.
And then that creates infighting because it's like the whole idea of cosplay being for everybody. It's, to me at least, cosplay is a form of love and self-expression. As long as you're not hurting anybody and your love doesn't come at the expense of sadness or hate, which is how I get around the whole don't be ignorant argument, then everything should be fine. Me cosplaying, and also I'm a dark-skinned male cosplayer, so if I did follow that mentality of accuracy above all else, I would be very limited in what I would be allowed to cosplay.
Mm-hmm.
So similar to sort of Attack on Titan, there was a lot of discussion that came out around the show. A lot of it wasn't healthy, but I sort of liked the fact that people could at least take the opportunity to express where they were coming from. And even if the show does lean one way, it's very clearly a show about expressing love for a craft. I even read the manga, and in the back of the manga, the creator has a lot of cosplay friends and went out of her way to like try to cosplay with them, try to visit all of these stores that are real life stores in the show to like understand it. So I also get from a writer's perspective where the show is coming from, because it's not being written by a cosplayer. It's being written by somebody who is starting cosplay for the first time and all the awkward growing pains that can kind of come with it. And I think everybody that cosplays can relate to that. So it is probably one of my favorite romantic comedies of this year, if only because I'm unable to forget it for both all of the right and all of the wrong reasons. That's probably fair. The best way that I could say it.
I don't think anyone else put this on their list for the top five. I watched the first couple episodes of it, and it was something that just sort of I fell off of, but not for any like particular reason. I appreciated the animation quality. I thought the sexy was sexy as opposed to being like weird and or awkward and gross. So like, mm-hmm. I enjoyed that. I liked both the characters' personalities. I liked that they like appreciated each other's hobbies and when they weren't typically, you know, they weren't typical. Like the main male character works under his grandfather who makes traditional Japanese dolls, and he's really interested in like being really good at painting their faces, and he has one in his room that I think he talks to.
Yeah, he carries her with him wherever he goes.
I didn't know it went that far, but okay. That's okay. He can do that. That's okay. And then Marin, she's not just a cosplayer, but I mean, she likes to play like sexy games, and specifically like the like bishoujo games, which typically aren't targeted towards women, and then likes to dress up at them as them. You could take that two ways. Like, she's a fantasy insert character. Here's your girl who likes the games that you like to play and there likes to dress up.
A lot of many pixic dream girl comparisons. Yeah.
But on the other hand, I've played a lot of those games. So, you know, like, if, that's fine too. Girls can like those games too. That's all I'm going to say about it. So, well,
the funny thing that I like about Madden as a character is that she doesn't seem to like the sexy games for the sex or for the fan service. She likes it because they're empowering stories about the women in them. And that's part of the reason why she wants to cosplay them so much. And I think that's why I also don't mind the fan service, because it doesn't feel gross. It mm-hmm. just feels like, here's an awkward boy trying to adjust to probably one of the first mm-hmm. girls who's ever actually shown him the time of day. And with a girl who in general is either very airheaded or likes to present herself, kind of like Harley Quinn, like very sex, presents herself in a very sexy, confident way.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that. I think my big thing with fan service is when it's like not done consensually, like we're looking at parts of the character that the character does not want us to look at. Yeah. Then that's when it gets uncomfortable. But I never, okay, there was one scene in the show with a completely different character where they did do that.
Yeah, the Juju scene.
Yeah, the bathroom scene was
the one thing that like knocked it out of the running for my top five, because I did consider it.
That is totally
because fair. I also like I haven't cosplayed in a long time, and I've never cosplayed at a high level, but I have done it, and I have friends who are high level cosplayers, and so like I could definitely like really appreciate a lot of the cosplay stuff. And like, I really like, I agree that it did feel like kind of like sex positive in its fan service. Like the characters were participants in it. You know, it seemed like it was coming from a place of like real experience, not just repeating the same thing, except for that joke with Juju about no hair and.
Yeah,
I remember that. Being
that killed it for a lot of people that I know. Not for me. I did finish it out, but I think that was the lowest
episode I rated, even lower than the dark skin episode. Because aside from that one thing, that was a really good episode. I just think you could have done anything else to, because she doesn't even technically do it in the show. It's a fake out.
Oh,
The whole point of the episode is that Gojo doesn't feel comfortable making the costume for that character because they're so revealing. Mm. And so that's the first time Mountain actually doesn't cosplay for Gojo's sake. And it's supposed to be them getting closer. You literally could have done that with like anything else besides like a tan character, which is the main thing that bothers me. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I do agree I completely understand that. That was, I did not like the way they treated that character. After that, it's fine. But that was probably the worst character introduction the show could have had.
Yeah, I am actually like, I had an interesting thing when I was looking back. That was my number one of the season.
Oh,
Yeah, and it's an interesting thing, because when I went back, I actually picked shows that were below it that have now risen up on this year overall top 10. Part of it was like, I think the fact that I never really thought about it again once I was done with it.
Mm-hmm.
But I do remember why it was so high, why I liked it so much. And it was a lot of it because like what you guys said about, oh, some people see her as a manic pixie dream girl, except that's not it, because a manic pixie dream girl is crazy and wild and appears in a man's life and fixes everything for it. Like teaches him how to live life. But the thing is, it's absolutely reciprocal. He helps her just as much as she helps him.
Yeah.
He they both improve each other's lives. She's not just a one note thing to make his life better. Everything like he allows her to express her cosplay in a much better way. Teaches her, lets her be the model portion of it more than the costume maker of it, which is what she seems to enjoy more anyway. Mm-hmm. And so you get a really good relationship between the two of them, which is why I liked it so much. But yeah, the fact that I just never really thought about it again, and I couldn't really remember why I placed it above certain other ones, is why it didn't make my top five in the end.
That's fair. I do agree. It was a very healthy relationship, surprisingly. And considering the feelings, that the fact that Madden is the one that kind of admits to herself that she likes him.
Right.
But she's also comfortable not really doing anything about it. She just likes being around him and doing things with him and having him do things for her. There's a give and take in their relationship. And I don't think we see a lot. There's a show that I just finished last season called More Than a Married Couple, Less Than Lovers, which I thought I was going to hate. I liked it a lot, but the whole point of that show is also, what do you bring to a relationship, and how do you see yourself in that relationship? And I don't think a lot of shows really deal with that aspect of romance, really. It's always about the pursuing, not about the connecting, I guess. So, yeah, I like that, and I hope it get. I think it's got a season two announcement, so I do look forward to seeing more of it, because I think we're past the worst of it as well, if what I remember from reading the manga is any indication.
All right, so for Caitlin, it's your number four, and you chose Bocchi the Rock, and this one was really popular this season as kind of a. There were a couple underdogs this season, but this one started out as one, and it gained quite the following. We just had an article go up today about how its album ranked number one in downloads on Billboard Japan on the day, like for the week, even though it was released like the final day of the week that they used to decide that. So, I mean, the music seems like it's probably really good. Do you want to talk more about Bocchi the Rock? I didn't watch this one because I had too many shows. So,
yeah, you know, it does go back to kind of a similar thing with me to Birdie Wing, and this is a recurring theme in a lot of my favorites. Is a lot of girls' music anime have been focused on kind of cuteness. You got your K-ons and you got your idol series and your love lives. And I've never been into those. Like I've never like really cared for the music. Idol music all sounds the same to me. But then I heard that Bocchi the Rock's music was inspired by Asian Kung Fu Generation, which has been one of my favorite bands since I became an anime fan. I don't even remember like how I heard them the first time, but like when I lived in Imeji, which is in Kansai, I went all the way to Fukuoka to see them because I didn't manage to get tickets for their Osaka or Kobe shows. So oh, wow. Like that kind of grabbed my attention, and yeah, like I just fell in love with the music and like the music scene, you know. It reminded me of like going to like seeing like Rilo Kiley back before Jenny Lewis was a very popular solo artist in like these little clubs in LA. I saw the Pillows at the Whiskey, which is really famous, but also like aesthetically very much resembles like Starry in the show. And Bocchi's like social anxiety. That girl needs therapy. Like, let's be real here. Like many anime characters, please get Bocchi some therapy.
Yeah.
No amount of being a popular musician is going to fix what's wrong with that girl. She might need some like anti-anxiety medication, like get her on some like mirtazapine or something. I don't know. But like, you know, the her specific forms of social anxiety, there were moments that hit really hard for me as someone who also like, boy, there were definitely times where I went to school with an anime t-shirt where I'm like, I hope someone talks to me about anime today. And then no one did. Like,
yeah. I have distinct memories of making like very strong style decisions in high school. I'm like, this is gonna get me friends, and no one anything to me about it.
A lot of the characters, like, they killed me because they remind me so much of my friends. I know Anijika in real life, and their fiance is a Rio. Like,
yeah.
So yeah, no, and I mean, yeah, just it all kind of came together in a really strong way for me. Just the music. This also did bump. Stone Ocean was my best of fall 2022.
Yeah.
But then I also, like, I was tired of writing about it. So I'm just like, I'm just going to put something else. So, like, also, like, shout out to Stone Ocean, because that was also an incredible series that I didn't put in my top five. But I would have if I hadn't already written, like, three
blurbs or reviews or something about it. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I just, Lynzee, sometimes I get so tired about writing. I've run out of things to say about it.
Yeah.
But I finished Mochi the Rock between doing my top of 2020, my top of fall mm-hmm. and my best five of 2022. I finished it. So I was like, I'm going to toss it on the list because it was really, really good. So there you go.
Did anyone else put Bochy on their list? James, I know you said you didn't get to watch it. AJ or Richard, did either of you get a chance to watch Bochy?
It wasn't on my radar at all. But in these past couple of weeks, seeing so many people talk about it, I added it to my list, just haven't had time to watch it.
Yeah.
I mean, I watched the first episode for the preview guide, like most of us did, I assume. Yeah. But this, it unfortunately hit in an area where I really didn't like it.
Oh, okay.
It's also like, what was the other one I had there? Watamote was the mm-hmm. same for me. Like, oh, lots okay. of people, they say, oh, I identify with the character so much. I went through the same stuff. It hits me, you know, right there. And I want her to overcome her problems. But when I watch that kind of stuff, because of course, you know, anime fans, you know, we've all probably been in a similar situation to how Bochy is.
Yeah.
But for me, like, I hate the fact that she's the butt of the joke.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
And that's what rubs me the wrong way about both Watamote and this. Now, that's not to say that, like, again, I'm going off of one single episode, which isn't enough to judge a show, let's be serious. But
yeah,
that's why I decided not to watch it, is because I just don't like awkward humor in general, and mm-hmm. I don't like watching the nerdy character be the butt of the joke. That's all. But then again, I've seen all the gifs and the stuff of like the like amazing art job that they're doing in it, like great animation things, really cool visuals and stuff like that, which make me want to watch it. But something tells me I'd probably still not enjoy it.
Drive with it.
Yeah. I did.
Yeah. Yeah.
They made a zoetrope for it. Zoetrope? I don't know how it's pronounced.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's cool.
So yeah, I mean that's my thoughts on it. Like, I think it's probably great for a lot of people, and I, you know, but every once in a while, you know, you have that thing where you're just like, oh, I don't think it's bad. I just don't think it's for me.
Kind of. Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, all right, you know, so all art is an act of interpretation between the creator and the audience. So, you know, we just responded to it different ways, and that's mm-hmm. cool. You know, I don't hate you for it much.
I don't think anyone thought that you did, Caitlin, but thanks for pointing was that out.
Was there a threat of that?
All right, so this next one is James's number four, and it's my number two. And I believe, Caitlin, it's also on your list as well. And that is Akiba Maid War, aka, like, this was my dark horse of the most recent season, and
I don't think anyone think about expected it all the time. Show to be as good as it was. Yeah. Like, I think one of the reasons it's on my list is because, you know, sometimes, like, you see a trailer, and I remember when I first saw the trailer, I was like, oh, it's gonna be like a maid show, but there's gonna be some violent twist, right? You know, like, it says war in there, and it's gonna be actually some kind of war. I get it.
Yeah,
but I never really, like, put two and two together before watching it that they were going to commit so freaking hard to what if every Yakuza crime movie ever made, but with cute maids. And yeah. It turns out that even if your show is rooted in one joke, if that joke is really funny and executed to an insane level of commitment, you might just have a masterpiece on your hands. I don't know. I mean, Lynzee, you and I, we've spent like a dozen
12 weeks talking about the show. Talking about the show. Yeah, on the podcast. Yeah, so but I mean, say, I can talk about it for days. Yeah,
I know. Ranko is one of the all-time great heroines as far as I'm concerned.
She is my best character of the year.
Yeah, she's just the best. A freaking statue erected in Akihabara right now for all to see and worship forever. Yeah. The Moe Moe Kyun is going to be something I probably get tattooed onto my arm or my back or something at some point with a little pig doodle. Moe Moe Kyun. And it stuck the landing. And when an anime original this good can stick the landing that well, you got to respect it. You just have to.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's, I don't know what else to say. It's Akiba Maid War. What do you guys think of Akiba Maid War?
I mean, if you haven't watched it yet, I mean, like James pretty much summarized it, but I think one of the things that really puts it over is that like you could do maids as Yakuza, but I feel like a lesser show would have made all the maids really dumb, like in a flighty, airheaded sort of way, but it doesn't. Like Ranko is a hardened ex-felon who just wants, she's 36 years old, but she wants to be a maid, whereas that means a gangster, but also, you know.
But also literally a cute maid that does waitress stuff.
Like, yeah, she got way better at her ketchup drawing. She was committed to it, you know.
An inspiration to us 35-year-olds, yes, honestly.
Really, an icon for the ages. Favorite, like if I had to pick a favorite episode, like it's hard to pick a favorite episode. One that sticks out to me, and maybe Caitlin, you can chime in one of yours, and James, you as well, and anyone. I don't know if Richard or AJ watched it.
Oh yeah, watched the whole thing.
AJ, you got it. It's just a good time.
I know. From start to second finish. Verse, same as the first. Same thing with Bochy. It's like, oh okay, that's. I didn't even look at it, and then it started blowing up more and more.
Easily. Yeah.
I'm like, okay, I'll probably need to look at that soon.
I think it's a hard choice. I mean, I knew the series was good with the poker episode when, like, they didn't win at poker when every writing convention said that they should have pulled through in the end. I'm like, oh no, these guys are going to lose. And they're going to die. So the Rocker just, like, shoots everyone. But no, I think the panda bit, like, the conclusion of the panda bit was so good for me. So you have to, all the maids are animal themed, without getting too much into it. All the maids are animal themed, and theirs in particular are pig themed. And in this, but for reasons that are never explained, there's a panda that lives in the cafe, and it just hangs out on a tire swing and eats bamboo. And sometimes shows, you know, human intelligence enough that we think it's someone in a suit. And then they give the panda a backstory, and it's like this girl who survived like an attempt to kill her by a hitman and wandered upon a park that had like panda playground stuff going on and just adopted that as her entire identity. And
as we all have been tempted to do at some
point. And do you know who played her?
Yes, it was
Which is a joke in and of itself, it's almost.
Aya Hirano, the voice actress from Haruhi. And so she doesn't talk for like the majority of the series.
Who had to disappear for several years. Yeah.
Like, because of death threats and whatnot over her decisions to, you know, have a sex life. So yeah, there's layers to it. There's all kinds of layers to it that you could dissect as well about like the commodification of youth and all these other sorts of things. And I like it when Nagomi gets the aviators at the end. That's also good.
She's Blackport.
When she's Blackport. Richard, what was your favorite Moe Moe Kyun moment?
Oh,
Richard's frozen.
Oh, no, I'm back. Sorry.
Okay.
No, for me, like, Nothing in that whole show. I was hoping it would, but nothing ever beat the musical number from the first episode.
Oh yeah, the
Yeah.
With the guns.
That is the most amazing scene I think I've ever seen. Yeah. Like in an anime, period. And I literally mean that. Mm-hmm. Like it's so heavily layered with like subtext and like jokes. Like the knives look like glow sticks.
Yeah.
Her gun kata poses are traditional otaku fan dances for idols. Like all of that stuff is joke after joke. But what's really funny to me was like how much detail was in it. There's a cut where you see her aiming like this, and then it switches to her like this, and then back and forth with the music.
Yeah.
And what the simple thing to do is just to flip the frame back and forth, right?
Yeah.
Except she has two different kinds of guns. And they didn't flip the frame. They literally made sure that the guns switch hands. Like,
oh, really? I didn't even notice that.
Yeah, yeah. She has a revolver and like a Glock, right? Like,
right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I've watched that scene way too many times. But like that was kind of the thing that got me about it. I was like, they put so much thought and so much detail into this one joke because they knew it was their one chance to make people come back next week.
Yeah.
And every other week. Like, especially because it had terrible trailers. I just wanted to say that.
Yeah, I didn't know what I was thinking, what was going to happen.
Basically,
how do you make a trailer for it? Because you would ruin right? The entire, right? Like,
right, yeah, right. Yeah. And so they basically just, you know, had pixels over like any of the Yakuza bits for the thing. And honestly, that didn't make me too interested. But man, like, honestly, the preview should have just been that scene. That should have been the trailer. They should have just put that right out there and been like, Akumen Raid War coming soon. Watch this 36-year-old maid just like murder a whole bunch of rabbit girls while dancing. It's great. Go for it.
Yeah. See, the trailer, honestly,
yeah.
The trailer actually had the opposite effect on me because I saw that trailer and I was like, I don't know what's going to happen here, but it's going to be weird and I'm going to be there for it. And lo and behold, it was weird and I was there for it. I mean, that first sequence is definitely like that hard to beat, and I don't think the show ever did top that. But I think overall my favorite episode was the boxing one.
Oh yeah, that the Hajime no Ippo jokes in it.
A lot of references and jokes. That's also the episode that brought us Zoya.
Yeah,
underrated character.
I also remember that there's like an extended Grave of the Fireflies joke too, and I think they did that.
So like,
so bad.
The whole show is just like, I think another like front runner for one of my favorite episodes was like the one where they had like the trainer come in.
Yeah, yeah.
And like,
oh gosh,
and Shippon. Like was so amazing in that episode because I love Ranko and I love Nagomi, like, but I think Shippon might be my favorite.
Because
she's like
my makeup's baller, yo.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like she just doesn't give a crap. Like, so she was so great in that episode.
Period piece. Until
it takes place in the '90s. Yeah.
And then you remember that, like, the Gyaru fashion there's an even different context there. Because it's not like when you see that kind of character in, like, a modern 2010s anime, right?
Yeah.
Like, she's, like, OG, like, she's rocking the blonde hair. She's making it look good.
Yeah.
So, she's great.
That's good stuff. All right, so my number four, I think, is on a couple people's lists as well. I know it's on, I'm pretty sure it's on AJ's. And that is... Spy Family.
There we go.
There we go. I was like, I've seen this one. This is a good one. Yeah. So this is Spy Family. We got both halves of the first season this year. I liked the first half a little more, but regardless of that, like, I love these guys. Like, it's not reinventing the wheel. So that's why it didn't place higher for me. You know, it's kind of like a how I used to watch certain sitcoms with my parents. It was something that I could just put on. There's not a lot of like lore or backstory to get into it. It's really well animated. It's got some tight scripting. Anya is irreplaceable in my heart. Lloyd's a hottie. And I mean, Yor's great too, although like I have some more quibbles with her personality than the other characters. But yeah, it's just consistently a really good time. And, you know, Bond is great too. Can't forget the dog. So,
Worf.
Favorite episode of this, probably. I mean, I like the one where Anya and Becky went shopping. That was really cute. I just like watching her interact with the, like, her classmates even more than like a lot of the spy background stuff. Like whenever it's an Anya school episode, I like those ones a lot.
The dodgeball one was great.
The dodgeball one was really good. Her just continually failing at everything, but you know, she's earnest. I love her imagination. And you know, she's got a good heart. She saved a kid from drowning by drowning, but also, you know, it brought attention to the other kid drowning. So she's good.
She got a gold star.
She got a gold star for it. Yeah. Yeah.
I saw a great cosplay of that kid from the dodgeball episode.
Oh, the big one?
Yeah.
That was the funniest joke.
Just this giant sixth grader, I think he was, or yeah.
Oh
no, he was a first grader.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, they're all first graders.
The joke, same age as Anya, he just looks 30 and jacked.
The joke when he goes "Papa" and like runs up to his dad just like killed me. Mm-hmm.
Was this one? Did this one make your list, Caitlin?
Not quite. No. It was one that I watched all of, and that I really, really enjoyed. It didn't quite make the list. I think in part because it is something that is very much designed to kind of go in perpetuity, and I have less patience for those kinds of shows. I like something that has like a little bit of a sense of a forward momentum.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, you know, Lloyd and Yor are both super hot. Like, yeah, you know.
They were the Anya, first traps of the year, I think. Oh, and I saw more Yor cosplayers than maybe anything else at all the cons I went to this year. Like,
you know, and I mean, I adore Anya as someone who works with kids around that age. She is very much how like a child with psychic powers would be, because she may be able to hear the thoughts of everyone, but she doesn't understand them.
Yeah.
You know, if you're like talking about something in front of a kid, like they're not like they're going to hear it and they're going to use their own kid logic to try to fill in the pieces, but it's not necessarily going to be like right, you know? Yeah.
I have a good example of that. Growing up, my dad worked night shift. So he was often asleep during the day and worked at night, but it wasn't referred to as night shift. My mom always said my dad worked graveyard. I thought my dad was literally a grave digger for like a couple years as a child. Like for real. I did. Because he worked graveyard. So like,
yeah.
Graves, what else would that mean? Yeah.
He worked at a grocery store, you guys.
I mean, metaphorically, still kind of a graveyard, depending on the story.
Yeah.
He was working freight, so he was like loading boxes and stuff at night and overseeing the freight.
You know, for all of the cuts of meat there, that is kind of the graveyard in a sense.
The deli's not open at night.
But yeah, like, you know, I feel like the easy way to kind of get around it would be to make Anya like super precocious.
Yeah.
And you know, kind of, but no, she's very normal developmentally, intellectually, like probably not actually 6 years old. She's probably more like 4 or 5. Pretty sure she lied about her age.
Yeah.
It's implied she's not even 6.
Yeah.
Like, which would explain why she's having such a hard time keeping up in school, because like she's just
pronouncing
not ready
certain
for
words
it.
And stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Like. So yeah, you know, I mean, I cried at the Bond episodes. I tried to submit a Homestuck image going good dog best friend for my, you know, preview guide and did not get away with it. But you know, like, yeah, it's really, really good, but it just doesn't quite have that spark to put it in that top five for me.
James, was it in your top five?
No, and it's honestly kind of the same thing where I love the show. I did fall off season two a little bit, honestly, with the after show and with Chainsaw Man. Keeping up with even just like a handful of shows is like a lot, and so that's one of the ones that sort of fell off. Mm-hmm. But it's also in the same way that some of the shows that I I didn't put on the list were really mostly because of like a lack of emotional impact. I think for this show, it would be that. Caitlin, you said that it feels like a show that's sort of designed to go forever in like kind of a sitcom-y way. And I think I agree that that's something that holds it back a bit for me, where, you know, all of the other shows that I really latched onto felt very, except for Attack on Titan, but they all felt very complete, and they all felt, you know, very much, you know, they told a very full and enriching story. Whereas watching Spy Family feels like, you know, kind of feels like checking in on one of your favorite sitcoms that, you know, makes you laugh, maybe makes you cry a little bit, but it also, it's not really designed to latch itself onto your brain in the same way that some of the other shows are. So it's one of the 12 shows that's tied for number 6. So,
oh, okay. AJ, this one did latch on for you though. Where did you rank Spy Family on your list?
It's number 3 for me. Oh, okay. And I completely agree with what everybody is saying. I think the best way to describe Spy Family is that it's a jack of all trades, because it's very, it hits a lot of different genre points. I don't know why my voice is all over the place tonight. I apologize. It's kind of a war story. It's a spy spoof espionage story. It is a sitcom. It's a cute kid slice of life show. It is mostly a comedy, but it does have some surprisingly serious moments. In the manga, it's like mostly serious right now. I think it has that forward momentum right now that you were talking, that you were looking for, Caitlin. But because we forget there's like a war in the background, and that's probably the one thing that I will kind of complain about a little bit compared to the source material. It felt like there was a bit more of this Orwellian stuff in the background, especially if you pay attention to some of the things the characters say, like the whole reason Yor is there in the first place is, I don't want to get arrested because apparently it's weird if a woman in her 30s hasn't settled down yet. I'm like, that's, wow. Okay. But they treat it so casually and they don't make a big deal about
it. I thought that was a joke that they made. I didn't realize that was like a, okay.
That's her entire motivation is because she thinks she might, you know, she'll become suspicious to her coworkers if she doesn't.
Right.
I thought that was like her misunderstanding, I thought that was like her taking a joke literally or something.
That's what I thought it was too. I thought it was her taking a joke literally.
No, it's because there is a secret police. There's like a bunch things. I think there is supposed to be even the whole like, oh, it's the East versus West. I think it's supposed to be kind of an allegory for the Cold War.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't find anything that definitively confirmed that, but there are some parallels there. And everyone's names
it's kind of East-West Germany sort of going on there for sure.
It's hard to pinpoint that because of everyone's names seem to have like different points of origins.
Yeah.
I even joked with my friend about how this is what Japanese people think non-Japanese people are named.
I mean, Lloyd's a real name. It's just, but they spell it
is
weird.
A real name. It's just a very peculiar and specific real name.
Yeah, Yor, I don't know about that one, but.
Because it's so rare to come across a show that can juggle all these different genres kind of seamlessly for the most part. I'd say like it succeeds 8 out of 10 times, but that's still a good score. I kind of need to commend it for that. My favorite episode is probably the castle episode in season 1.
Oh yeah, the
castle. Because I think that perfectly sums up.
So cute.
Yeah, I think it perfectly sums up everything that these guys are about. Anya is just a kid that like wants to live out her fantasies.
Yeah.
Yor is an unstoppable monster that doesn't realize it half the time.
Mm-hmm.
Lloyd is just trying so hard to keep everything together, which I relate to more than anything. And everyone else is just kind of along for the ride. And it's gorgeously animated. The soundtrack mostly doesn't stand out, but when it does, it really does. And yeah, I think it's one of those shows that most people can find things appealing in. And I think it's hard to come across shows like that these days. So that's why it made my list.
Nice.
All right, I think we're gonna move on to number three here with Richard's pick for number three. I was actually surprised how few people put this on here based on the level of like, I'm not gonna say hype, but it just seemed like people were really into this show when it was airing. But it was one that I missed, and that's is it Licorice Recoil?
Licorice Recoil.
It is Licorice. Okay.
Or just Lico Rico.
Lico Rico. Okay.
That's what most people call it. Yeah, this one is one that actually moved up in the rankings dramatically for me after the fact. So this is the reason why I like it. Like, and I really had to think about this, but we have a lot of anime out there that take a light concept and make it dark. So we have our Madoka Magica, we have stuff like that, right? Yeah. Where we take, oh, look how nice and cute magical girls are. Let's deconstruct this and make this dark as crap, you know, kind of thing, which I do like as well. But what this Lico Rico does is it takes something inherently very dark and makes it light.
Teenage assassins.
Right? Yeah. I mean, it's about basically teenage assassins that just straight up secretly murder everyone who does a crime. And that way there's, you know, no violent crimes in Japan.
Because is it kind of like Minority Report then, in that sense?
Although yeah, without... they're using kind of like the Dark Knight, everybody wiretapped kind of thing.
Oh, okay.
But they're using like an AI system that catalogs everybody's phone calls and stuff like that. Yeah. It's like a secret police state, and then they send out these schoolgirls to assassinate anybody who's going to commit a violent crime. But then we have our main character, who I chose the picture of. And basically she's the best of them, the absolute best assassin. She's a genius assassin, all that good stuff. And what does she do with her skills? She refuses to kill people. She does community outreach. And she literally goes and teaches Japanese language to immigrants because she speaks several languages as a assassin spy. Yeah. She opens a cafe where basically community leaders can meet and relax and get on the same page. Mm-hmm. Sorry, there's my camera disappearing again. So she does all this stuff, and it's basically a story that's about the battle between idealism and pragmatism. The society is highly pragmatic, and she's the idealist existing in that society.
Isn't there also like a pretty significant subplot involving a gay black man that works at the cafe too?
Her teacher is a gay black man working at the cafe, who has been basically inspired by her idealism, even though his job is to make her into even more of a violent killer, basically. And then there's also this whole other side of the story that's about the relationship between talent, responsibility, and personal freedom. Mm. Sure, her talent is killing. She is the best at it. So does she have the responsibility to use those skills for the betterment of her society, even though she doesn't want to kill people? Okay. And that's another big thing that's explored over the course of the show. And then, yes, then we also get, cute girls doing cute things, which is kind of really fun in this specific series.
Did anyone else watch this one? Because I can't.
I did.
You did? Yeah. Caitlin, it wasn't your favorite, though, because we've talked on Discord.
Oh, no.
I very, very narrowly avoided being my pick for worst.
Wow.
I didn't. Which
like your fighting words?
No, so I have forgotten enough about the show that I cannot clearly state exactly what it was that made it worst for me. It is lucky for everyone that I remembered that I hated Fruits Basket Prelude more than I hated this one because my husband was threatening to divorce me because he loved that show. I only ended up watching the whole thing because of my like weekly anime gathering with friends that I have, and everyone else was really into it. But basically, like, I mean, I thought that the show I didn't think the show did interesting things with its themes. I thought the main girls were kind of boring. I I loved Mika. I thought Mika was awesome. I thought Mika would be a much more interesting protagonist than either of the actual main characters. But yeah, no, I didn't like it. I didn't think that the show did what I wanted it to do with kind of what it was about and the setting. And so, yeah, didn't care for it.
It happens.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I'll also say, though, I did want to add, though, some of the most awesome gunfights.
Oh, yeah. It was a beautiful show.
And I do have to say, I love the visual storytelling in those fights of how she works so hard not to kill people. Like a guy, there's a great scene, I think in like the second episode, where a guy throws a grenade at her. Yeah. And so she basically throws a guy into another room, throws the grenade behind the door so that the door slams into him and he doesn't die by the explosion, but he gets taken out by the door. And it's like half a second, but it's like this really, you can see these little things that she does to make sure no one dies in the middle of doing John Wick fights and dodging bullets. And
that sounds cool. Yeah, this was another one that I always meant to check out, but then it didn't, I hadn't found time for it yet. So I have a pretty growing list of 2022 that I gotta like circle back on. I was looking at everything else, and we already did AJ's number three because he did Spy Family, and we already did Caitlin's number three because she did Akiba Maid War, and so we're going to James now with his number three, also a unique pick. This is Teasing Master yes. Takagi-san.
Yes, my time has come. First of all, I want to shout out to the other like three fans of this other show that I originally was going to do a whole thing where I had to tie them, but eventually ended up picking Takagi-san. But for the three other people that also love Demon Girl Next Door season two, just know that that's also basically my number three. That show is incredible. I went from literally having never heard of it before and accidentally watching it for preview guide because I thought it was a different show that I'd watched more of the first season of, to discovering, it's one of the best. But in the end, I ended up giving the edge to Teasing Master Takagi-san because for my money, as far as just pure like romantic comedy, you know, not necessarily something that's rooted in like a gimmick or a high concept like Kaguya-sama. But if we're just talking, you know, boy meets girl, you know, boy and girl fall in love, and we kind of watch that process develop, I don't know if I could name a better example in anime, at least recent anime that I've seen, than Takagi-san. And season three of Teasing Master Takagi-san is straight up just like masterpiece level, adorable to a degree that should be illegal. There's one episode in particular that involves a school play and an impromptu casting changeup that might literally be one of the top five cutest things I've ever seen in fiction. My heart.
Well, did they do Cinderella? Was it Cinderella?
It was like their own little homebrewed, like it was like Romeo and Julia or something. It was like a gender swapped Romeo and Juliet, except it didn't have anything to do with Romeo and Juliet. But okay. They did that thing where Nishikata here is he was not playing the romantic lead, while Takagi, of course, being the most popular girl in class, she got picked to play the Romeo princess character. But due to a series of comedy shenanigans, he has to literally swoop in at the very last minute to sweep her off of her feet and catch her from tripping and falling. And after, you know, 2.5 seasons of this girl more or less constantly having the emotional like high ground, as far as she knows how she feels, she knows that she likes him, she's just waiting for him to catch on. Mm-hmm. There's this moment where she is speechless over how just sweet and earnest and like genuinely romantic he is in that moment. And I might have literally died for a few seconds. I might have.
Did everyone hear James's voice get higher as he recalled that specific moment?
I'm sorry. I'm just, the show is so cute. And I know that each of the three seasons has been split up across a different streaming service, which is really annoying.
But, yeah.
And I know that people got initially turned off a little bit by the show because of the the teasing dynamic that, especially at first, made it seem like Nishikata might kind of be a victim of bullying. But the more you watch the show, the more you realize that these two are basically already married. Just only one of them knows it, and it's I don't know. It's basically my ideal romance anime. Like, it has pretty much everything that you could ask for. There's no creepy fan service. There's no, you know, there's an actual sense of growth and forward momentum every season. It's not like a show where they have like five love confessions a season and they'll just get conveniently forgotten. Mm-hmm. It's so good. And I cannot recommend it enough. It is all-timer as far as I'm concerned.
Does anyone else watch this? I already pulled the picture because I think the answer is no.
I watched the first season and I kind of avoided the show for that exact reason, James, that I thought that the power imbalance was a little frustrating. But I am in this new era right now where I hated the teasing genre and how popular it was getting. But I just reviewed Uzaki-chan. Not the best example because that season was pretty bad. but I'm up to date with the manga for that. I'm up to date with the manga for Nagatoro. And I'm not up to date with... This is finished, right? Teasing.
There's a movie. There's technically a whole sequel series about when they're married and have a kid. But that I don't know if that's ever gonna get an adaptation. It got a one-off adaptation in the anime that also melted my heart. But
that's the shoji one, the shogi one, right?
No. I think that's by the same creator, but yeah. Not but that's related. Not the sequel.
Okay.
Yeah, and that one's not very good, unfortunately. But.
Oh, I actually liked that. Because that felt a bit more even, where it's like
he just has to beat her in shogi, right? Or she has to beat him in shogi?
He decides he wants to beat her so that he can earn her respect as his shogi senpai.
Even though they both like each other. So it's really one of those things where she's trying to, it's more like she's trying to figure him out because he's so straight faced most of the time. And he'll say very direct off the cuff things, but she doesn't know how to process it. Whereas with him, he's just very straight. Nope, I'm not. You're cute. You're adorable. I love you. I will not confess to you until I beat you in shogi. so I found that very cute. But I have been meaning to give Takagi-san, because of that, I wanted to give Takagi-san another shot. It's a little bit hard because of the streaming service and the different dubs and all of that.
Yeah.
I might just have three different dubs as well.
Well, two and a half different dubs, because the first one was done by Funimation. And then the second one, completely different cast, done by Netflix. Mm-hmm. The third one was picked up by High Dive, who got most of the cast from the first season back. So,
weird.
It is weird, but welcome to licensing hell. that's my input on that show. I do need to give it another shot.
Well, for my number three, I'm confident that I'm the only person that picked this, mostly because I've accessed all the answers. But I picked Dance Dance Dancer, which I hope more people watch because it is a satisfying drama. Or if I just read you what I wrote in the feature for It Goes Live, this is the kind of drama-fueled mess that I like to roll around in like a raccoon on a late-night bender at Taco Bell. So this is my thing, okay? So like, I am a trash panda, and this is like my kind of trash. And don't misinterpret what I mean when I say trash, because like, it's beautiful. Like, the MAPPA animated it. The dance sequences are gorgeous. The character designs are consistent, despite the fact this is like an adaptation of a the creator's name is George Arakawa. I may have mixed up a syllable there, but like, he does these long, or she, actually, I don't know for a fact that George is he or she, these long, lanky bodies and like really big eyes. So like, if you're not into the proportions of the character designs, they can be a little off-putting. Everyone's got really long like necks that just like go
out to, I'm trying to make my neck grow as like an example, but anyway.
I mean, they all look like Natalie Portman from Black Swan, so it's pretty appropriate.
Yeah, yeah, I was gonna say, that's just ballet dancers.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, it, as far as I know, it does really well with the ballet aspects as well. It's got, you know, the up and coming protagonist who thinks he can get through this art form just on vibes. And then you've got the guy in the front here who's like a prodigy, who's had ballet literally beaten into him by his grandmother his entire life. And so they end up having this kind of like battle of like approaches to art, like from a classical standpoint versus a more like interpretive modern standpoint. Everyone's really messed up. So they've all got a lot of baggage they need to work through, and teenage hormones are going wild, and it's consistently gorgeous to look at. I loved it. And there's a, if you were to watch any episode, watch it completely out of context, go watch episode 5 where they do Swan Lake, and Junpei, who's the boy there in the background, he's playing the Prince Siegfried, Miyako, who's the girl he has a crush on and is technically Luo, the guy in the front's cousin, but you know, that doesn't matter in anime. Luo's playing Rothbert, and Junpei, instead of going along with the script, like puts up more of a dance battle fight over when he's supposed to die, and it really pisses Luo off, and he goes like feral, like ballet feral, and like the animation changes to like these big streaky like charcoal lines, and it's really intense, and that's just like halfway through the show, and there's like more stuff like that. There's, it's great.
If we were doing like a best episodes of 2022 list, yes, that episode almost certainly would have like made my top 5. That episode is incredible.
Yeah. Yeah. We do have best moments, James, and someone picked it for their best moment. So
if this year didn't have a Chainsaw Man, yeah, things would have been a lot easier to figure out. But yeah, this show's good.
Yeah, that's one of the shows that I didn't consciously drop, but like just kind of everything. It was, you know, we had 2 seasons that were like kind of quiet, and then 2 really busy seasons this year, and this was in one of the busy seasons.
Yeah,
and so like, I don't know. I also got really, like, really angry at Junpei, just like, because of like, that was a really great,
he's
moment,
a self-centered,
a really great episode,
but he's like,
I got
14,
so mad, like, because like what he did messed up things for so many people, like in real material ways.
Yeah.
And
he like screwed over the entire studio when he went,
oh my god,
like, the parents were angry because he stole the spotlight from their daughters who were like 8 and have been practicing for their recital, and then you get this like this monkey kid,
he harmed his teacher's livelihood.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
For
art though, Caitlin, it was for art. And,
you know, like, so like, I mean, I'm not saying I'm not gonna like go back and finish it at some point. You know, that's always on the table, but
too, a couple people like filled me in, they're like, oh yeah, by the way, like Luo eventually goes to another country. I won't do manga spoilers, but it gets even messier. Way messier as they get older. So anyway, go watch this. It's got my endorsement specifically. I forgot to do the ticker the whole time. This is Dance Dance Danseur, and that's my best French accent that I could do because I took a year.
Danseur.
I took a year of French when I was a freshman in high school, so that's best I can do there. But so that was my number 3. So I guess we're moving on to number two. And we've been starting off with Richard each time, right, Richard? Yeah. All right.
Pretty much.
You reviewed this show.
I did. And continue to.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Because it's not done.
Yeah. Is it a
They're not season? Even taking a break. Yeah. No, it's it's 20 episodes. So I guess, 20. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, they're not even stopping over the New Year's, which is kind of.
Oh, that's unusual.
Thing. Yeah.
This is The Eminence in Shadow, right?
Yeah. The Eminence in Shadow is it's one of those things that it takes like a paragraph to explain what it is. But the shortest version I've ever come down to is it's about a guy who's a Chunibyo who gets reincarnated in a fantasy world and doesn't realize he's actually become the overpowered head of a shadowy organization that he's always pretended that he is.
I've read the manga for this. I read the manga. I completely forgot that it was airing this season. I wanted to watch
this.
It's so good. It's so over the top good. But like, it's because his whole shtick is that he doesn't want to be the hero in the limelight. He wants to be the one who supports the hero in the background. And he thinks everyone else is in on that. When in reality,
he thinks they're all playing pretend with, like, he's playing pretend, even though he's going out and killing people. Yeah, he's LARPing, but like, he's so insane that, like, he does go out and kill people, and he knows that he's killing people, and he's just like, oh no, they're just bandits or thugs or something. It's fine if I kill them, whatever, you know, kind of thing. It's fine. It's all part of my LARPing, so it's cool. It's just the whole thing is the entire fantasy world is actually structured around the idea that everything he makes up for his like setting of being this head of a mysterious organization fighting a cult to save the world or whatever, all of it's true. Yeah. Everything he makes up off the cuff is always true. And it's you get this really, really funny dark comedy where, for example, there's a scene where the school gets taken over by terrorists because that's what happens, right? And what does he do? Does he help his friends, right? Does he help his friends? No, he's like, finally, my time has come. So he goes and finds the tallest building in the school to stand on top and monologue about what's happening. So and while looking down on all the terrorists who have rounded up his friends, and he's like, yes, and now I shall stand up on this tower. This is like the most edgy thing I could do right now. And I'm going to finish it by jumping off the building, falling head first, and miraculously surviving because that's what you do. Right?
Yeah.
So there's like that side of it. And then the other side of it is he has a secret identity. You know, he's Tuxedo Mask, but he's also Darien. So he's got to be like this, like he's decided like, oh, I have to be the backgroundiest background character ever, which really means that he's anything but that. Yeah. Because he gets in a fighting tournament where he gets hit and does the thing where like he spirals and like blood comes out in a spiral as he gets knocked back. Uh-huh. And it's like, and then he, you know, normally that's okay. Yeah. Background character got whooped, but he's like, oh no, I have 37 other versions of this thing and I'm never going to get another chance to do them again. So he just keeps getting back up and getting knocked around in crazy ways, which makes him look like the most determined person alive rather than a background character.
Right.
And so you keep getting back and forth between all these things. It's half slapstick, half dark comedy, but it's played so completely straight that there are times when he is doing something that is, you know, the most cliche, edgy thing you've ever seen in your entire life, but you're sitting there going, yeah, that's pretty cool, man. He's so cool right now. Yeah, look at him. Look at him, like, in his billowing black cloak and, like, looking down and, you know, talking down to the bad guy and whispering cryptic shit that nobody understands.
It's very easy to get drawn into, like, the bullshit he's saying.
Right. And it's just so funny.
Richard, I have a question for you because this is something I've seen some of your reviews and I've seen some of the people that I follow on Twitter that are also fans of the show. The only episode of this show that I watched was the first one.
Right, which is crazy because it's not like that's from like the fourth book. That's a scene from the fourth book.
Oh, really?
Threw everybody for a loop because we're all like, whoa, this is way, like, chronologically, sure, it's first, but like, yeah.
Well, that's is that first episode tonally very indicative of, because the thing that I found so interesting reading your reviews and seeing people like share some of the stuff that happens is I got like the edgy, like the delusional levels of edgelordiness, but that first episode to me didn't really strike me as particularly like funny or even really in on the joke. But is that something that like the actual like main body of the story is more like on the level about?
Compared to the manga, which is the other easily accessible version of the story, that one's a lot more jokey in it. The anime very much plays it all very, very straight. There are silly comical things that happen to him. But yeah, it's that's kind of like, that's the dark comedy aspect of it, is like he thinks he's just pretending, even though he's murdering people constantly. But yeah, like, so
I think that's the thing that in the first episode,
the problem with it is you don't get his viewpoint on what's going on.
Yeah, because I didn't realize that he was just pretending and that the joke was that he wasn't actually pretending. I thought that he just was this guy.
Like in the original world, like that's kind of the thing is like, he's LARPing. He's, you know, that's just what he's doing. And then when he gets to the fantasy world, he has magic. And so that can bring his LARPing to a ridiculous new level. And that's kind of how that works. But yeah, it's when you get his thoughts on the things, it is what makes it just rise to a whole new level. Because you get the other characters who are all like you know, his harem of beautiful girls who are his secret agents who would do anything for him. And he's like, man, isn't it nice that they drop by every once in a while and will join me in my game of LARPing? They're good pals. They're good pals, you know? You get that too. Right, exactly. Like, you know, they have bodyguards for him and they'll do whatever he says. And he's just like, I mean, he is literally what one of the jokes that is always one of my favorites is he buys the most expensive art he can, the most expensive rug he can, the most expensive chair he can. He saves money from all these menial jobs that he does just so that he can sit in the moonlight in this chair looking depressed, drinking wine, so that one of his friends will walk in and be like, look, surrounded by opulence, he's so tortured, you know?
Yeah.
It's that kind of humor. Now, I understand it's not for everybody, but if that's the kind of humor that really gets you, you'll enjoy the show. But if not, like, yeah, I know it's very much an acquired taste kind of thing, but for me, it's like it was made for me.
Because that sounds really funny, and I just think that maybe one of the reasons that I didn't really pick up on the show is that that angle isn't super apparent in that premiere, where it really just kind of seems like he's like an overpowered, you know, he wants to like fight crime and then he gets his magic powers. But the way that you're describing that, the show's perspective on the character makes it sound like a lot of fun. So I think I might have to check that out.
You might want to read the manga then, because the first volume is all the setup for how he gets to the world and where his mindset comes from. Okay. That's why I loved it.
And they do cover it, but it comes up in like the second and the second episode of the series is basically all that and how he like starts the organization kind of on accident, all that other good stuff. But yeah, it really is like every week I'm so happy to watch it. You know, I'll say this, there is a staggering amount of fan service, which if that turns you off, like, yeah, I totally understand. But if you're highly desensitized to it after decades of watching anime, like me, and I assume some others in this call, you'll probably enjoy it.
Yeah. All right. This next one is like a double number two. It's my number one. I considered skipping it just to stay to the end, but you know, James, AJ, you picked Chainsaw Man as your number two. This is my number one. And man, what can we say about Chainsaw Man that hasn't already been said? Let's let AJ go first, because James and I have talked a lot about Chainsaw Man and I want to hear what AJ has to say about it.
I marathoned this manga like in 2 days when I was feeling depressed a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
Thinking, why are these two girls on my timeline so much?
you mean Kobeni and Himeno, right?
What a similar story to my own situation.
Like, why are Power and Makima on my timeline like every single day? Fine. Mm-hmm. What's the joke? And then first comment, you're all degenerates, is what I want to say. But no, it's really good. I actually read I forget the creator's name because I'm so bad with names. I read his other stuff after Chainsaw Man, so I have a better understanding of what his style and his approach is. There's just something like when you describe something as raw and dirty, sometimes people mean that literally. Sometimes people mean that aesthetically. The thing about Chainsaw Man is that from an outside looking in, it just looks like edgy, violent bullshit. And that's kind of what I thought it was. And arguably it is. But all the characters are coming from such specific places of like wants and desires and how that feeds into the larger world. It's really, really well thought out in the way that it revolves around this poor kid who I feel like the internet has turned a little bit too much into a meme.
Oh, yeah, okay.
To the point where I worry that his depth is actually lost a little bit. I actually spoke with Ryan Colt Levy, the dub actor for Denji, because he really liked the write-up that I did at New York Comic Con when the premiere started. And the thing about Denji is he's coming from a place that I think most people can't relate to, like where you literally don't have anything. You're willing to sacrifice so much for so little out of just pure survival. When you come from that place, nothing phases you anymore. And that's why he's so feral most of the time, because he already died once. He already lost his best friend. He's already suffered incredible pain as a child. Nothing is going to phase this kid. He just wants to get the bare minimum that most other human beings take for granted.
And he doesn't even understand that it's the bare minimum. Like right. That's kind of what makes it genuine.
It's like,
exactly.
It's both pure and edgy at the same time. And I kind of love it about that. Like it's so raw yet wholesome. And like the relationship Denji has with power, it's, I fight with my siblings in that exact same way.
Yeah. But
these guys could literally kill each other if they wanted to.
Yeah.
Or the way Aki is just trying his best to keep everything together, even though you know there's no happy ending for him whatsoever. And when I read the creator's other stuff, it's like, oh, that's what he's good at. He's good at making these moments of like really quiet, really wholesome, really relatable moments. And then he steps on them in like the most violent, visceral way possible. But he does it in a way that it doesn't feel manipulative, I guess. Mm. So I really appreciate that. And yeah, I don't care that the internet thinks I'm a normie or whatever. Because you know what? Sometimes things, the reason why so many people talk about something is because it's good. So
yeah.
There.
No. That's, I think, my ongoing biggest gripe is, guess what, guys? Popular things are popular for a reason. It's because they speak to a large amount of people. And don't get me wrong, that means that, sure, they probably miss out on a lot of other stuff. But, I mean, if it speaks to a lot of people, there's probably something to it.
Sometimes I'm
worried about the fact that things speak to a lot of people with certain like certain very popular media properties. Like, why does it speak to so many people? That's not good.
James, did you want to add anything to?
Every single thing that everyone's already said. I think. And Lynzee can speak with experience. Whenever I get the chance to talk about like the filmic technical aspects of things right. in anime, I get very excited because for reasons that we've discussed, that's just not something you get to see a whole lot. You know,
yeah.
it's very difficult to do. It's very expensive. It's very challenging on an artistic level. And even if Chainsaw Man weren't an incredibly well-written, well-paced, surprisingly deep, surprisingly affecting horror, comedy, drama, workplace satire thing, which it is. On a production level alone, the things that MAPPA is accomplishing with this show leaves me
insane.
Yeah. I mean, legitimately, the fact that there are in almost every episode, there are single cuts that I could write paragraphs about. Because not only do you see those filmic cinematic techniques, but they're being executed so well that you can extrapolate exactly why they're using them. You know, I was just on Twitter and a couple of our mutuals were going off about how there's that one shot in episode 4 where like Aki has to choose between an apple and a cigarette. And yeah. it's this simple, straightforward, you know, symbolic thing, but the way that it's shot, the way that it's edited, the fact that they take that amount of time, which in anime terms is like thousands of dollars and dozens of man hours, the fact that they take that time to make sure that they linger on that moment so that it has the impact that it should, and that they do that not just for like maybe, you know, one or two scenes every couple of episodes, but for literally every single scene of every single episode, I think that truly deserves to be recognized. On a technical level, just as like a work of animation, I think Chainsaw Man is easily, without question, the most impressive thing I've seen, not just this year, but probably this decade, as far as like TV anime goes.
It's ever. Insane. Yeah. This is my number one for like a lot of reasons that James just touched on and that AJ has touched on as well. Like the only thing that I think I can add to it is that I also read the manga before it came out. I marathoned all of it and read it all in like 2 or 3 days. And I did go and read his other stuff too, like Goodbye Eri and Looking Back.
Goodbye Eri is so good.
Goodbye Eri is so good.
I'll never look at walking away from explosions the same
again. Sometimes your mom's inside that hospital, you know, and then it blew up. It's just where was I going? I lost my train of thought. It's just amazing to me that like they pulled this off at the level that they did, but I also feel like they built on some of the groundwork from the manga to really create like a more fully emotional, fleshed out story. Like I feel way more connected to Aki in the anime version than I fully felt when I was reading through the manga. That might be because I, you know, was speed running it and it didn't sit with me the same way that you know, people who were reading it week to week. But like I felt like they gave him way more emotional weight, and they definitely gave Himeno like a ton more emotional weight, and the void. I know, like when in the manga, spoilers, guys, okay, she's dead. So in the manga, like that kind of washed over me and it didn't really stick with me nearly to the same degree that the anime did, where they're, you know, engaging in all those flashbacks about her and Aki's relationship, and they, you know, the way that Aki cries after he reads her letters. I mean, he cries in the manga, but like he like ugly cries in the anime. Like you see his face just, you know. And it feels real in a way that, like, I don't know if they did any kind of rotoscoping for that. Like, I wouldn't be surprised if that was one of the tools that they use for some of this, but it just hits really hard. And then completely separate from the emotional aspect of it, I always keep coming back to what I think was one of the peak episodes of the season, which is when the assassination attempt on Division 4 happens, and we get the subway car scene with Makima and the guy who was sitting next to her. And I mean, all of that, again, it happens in the manga, but the sound design and the way that the entire scene is framed, I felt like I was at the movies. Like it was really like cinematic in its execution. There's a part where she, you know, she makes a small conversation and then they go into a tunnel, and then you can just hear the people in the seats in front and back. You can't see them, but you hear them all lean over at the same time. You hear them all unzip something at the same time because they're retrieving their weapons. And then they just like, I feel like I'm talking about shooting people a lot during this podcast, but then they shoot everybody. And it's just, it was intense. It was intense. And Tatsuki Fujimoto, I love his comic work. I love how he frames his stories, his page setup. He does some really inventive things in his execution of a story via layout and things like that. But I feel like MAPPA has taken that and made something else that fully embraces animation as a medium for the story compared to what we were getting with what was a fully realized comic realization of the story. Well, they're both perfect, I think, but I'm glad that MAPPA didn't do a frame by frame recreation of the comic and instead like fully embraced motion to execute those scenes.
Just it's an adaptation. It's not right. just yeah.
Mm-hmm. And not enough series do that. It's like,
oh my gosh, I'm so tired of the frame by frame.
Using manga as storyboards. Right. Stop it.
It's like what you were saying is it like because it's animation, it can force you to breathe, to slow down,
yeah,
to take a few minutes. Like you were talking about, you know, the assassination and everything like that. Yeah, in the manga, she appears a little bit and then she's gone and that's kind of it. But this like makes us stay with her much longer than if you're flipping pages.
Yeah.
And it's one of the things that an anime can do that a manga can't. It has control over the speed at which you are able to get the story. And because of that, they can, just by slowing something down, you can make something so much more important than it would be if you could just, you know, switch to the next page.
Sure.
And yeah. they do a lot of really good pacing in Chainsaw Man. Mm-hmm. That's absolutely true.
Yeah.
Well, and I think that as a manga artist, Fujimoto's best skill, you know, even divorced from his writing, I think as an artist, his greatest skill is his pacing, the way that he can lay out action scenes, dialogue scenes in a way where you can tell that he's trying to control the way that his readers linger on certain images. But, you know, he can only do so much given that it's a static, you know, 2D medium. But I think that, you know, for all of the complaints that people have about like the color scheme maybe not being as wild or with the pacing of the episodes not being as like frenetic as they maybe want. I think this is an instance where the people making the show, they so get what Fujimoto is trying to do because they understand that, you know, sometimes the reasons that he has like a single conversation take 2 to 3 pages is because he wants his audience to sit with that information. And they know that, hey, we can do that. And not only that, we have the time and the money and the talent to make it look freaking gorgeous, even if it is just two characters having a back and forth conversation. I mean, was there any scene, you know, speaking of fan service, was there any scene this year that was as like intense and erotic as the Makima and Denji conversation about what real intimacy is? Like, holy crap.
Yeah.
Like, and that's something that always gets me about anime and manga. So like Chainsaw Man, I didn't put on my top 5 list because I'm anime only and I really feel like the story is just getting started. Sure. But like that like floored me because I mean, I always come back to this quote from an interview that I did with Sayo Yamamoto where like, you know, fan service is like very childish because it's just kind of repeating the same tropes. But like, you know, every so often you'll see a scene that like really like pulls out like experience and like an understanding of intimacy. And like, I see that so rarely. And that was one of the most powerful, even though it was also a very creepy scene, right? Because she is grooming Denji big time. Like she has no business doing that with a child. And to the series credit, to Fujimoto's credit, like there's an understanding of that. Like, but like, yeah, no, that scene was just like, whoa. Yeah.
Because I've been watching.
Oh yeah, so, no, that is what intimacy is.
Yeah, you can, like see the breath fogging up the camera lens, like the act like, am I supposed to be watching this? This is like
sort of deal going on. Yeah, yeah, like I can still see the scene in my head. And they like they do these cutaways. There's a brief cutaway to like the desk, I think, and there's like spilled ink on it, like a spilled ink. And I'm like, oh, stuff like that. I'm like, I know what you're doing there. Yeah. All right, Caitlin, I think you're the only one who put this on your number two or on your list, at least out of this group. And I felt bad for kind of forgetting about this show. And this is Ya Boy Kong Ming, which had like one of the best OPs of the year, for sure. What drew you to this in particular?
It's such a weird idea.
Yes.
You know, it shouldn't work, but it so does. Yeah. Like, and I mean, it's, you know, like, full credit to the original creator, because it's not an anime original, unlike most PA work series. But yeah. but choosing this to adapt, like, takes some fucking guts, right? Yeah. Like, PA works between this and Akiba Maid War, absolutely fearless.
Yeah. I'm excited for Buddy Daddies because of this.
Buddy Daddies, I have some concerns, like, because, like, for a long time, my whole gimmick was, like, I like anime dads. And now I'm getting kind of tired of it because it's getting overplayed. But your boy Kong Ming, you know, and I did have my husband sitting next to me to explain all of the Romance of Three Kingdoms stuff.
Yeah.
But, like, you know, it pulled in so many things that I normally do not care about. I do not care about EDM. I do not care about the Romance of Three Kingdoms. I do not care about rap battles outside of Hypnosis Mike.
Yes!
Yes!
Yes, no, Lynzee, you and I are together on that one.
Hypnosis Mike, like, it's good. It's bad good. Good bad. I don't know. But, yeah.
The rap battle in this series was better than anything in Hypnosis Mike. By a mile, like, just all of these completely weird ingredients came together to make something that's just so charming and special. You know, it really did feel like it took place in a living, lively world. It was just so fun, and just a really good time to watch.
Do anyone else want to chime in on your boy
Kong Ming? Sure. Yeah, I watched the whole thing. And here's the thing. While this didn't make my list, the Be Crazy For Me, the song, did make my list for our best songs of the year. And the reason is this, like, when you take a manga like this, it's super easy when you're writing the manga being like, she sang a really cool song that everybody liked and totally changed this guy's way of viewing the world. Yeah, sure. You could just write it. Who cares, right?
Yeah.
But when you animate it, you have to show me that, like, not that this girl can be the greatest musical star in the world. You have to show me that. If she is supposed to literally with 15 seconds of music make an ancient Chinese general change his entire reason for living, you have to show me that. And you don't, I'm not down with it. You've lost my suspension of disbelief. And it does it. It absolutely does it. Her on stage in the devil costume, 15 seconds of a song, and I'm sitting there going, yeah, okay. Yeah,
I'd she could be a CD. Star.
Yeah, I'd buy that CD. And the way they continue to use that song throughout is you actually get various chunks of that song in like the next 4 or 5 episodes, so you never hear the exact same parts of that song. But every time it makes you go, like, she, you know, she has this kind of, I would say, like, I don't know what to call it, like sweats in a backwards hat kind of style. It's not okay. Anything like super flashy or anything.
I believe it's called street
fashion. Okay. So she goes into street fashion, but she doesn't look but even though she almost blends in compared to like the other acts that she comes up against, it doesn't matter because she really is that good of a singer. And all the things that Komei does Kong Ming does, the Japanese
different
Kong
pronunciation Kong
is simply to set the stage for her. He doesn't make her better. He doesn't, he doesn't make her do voice training. He doesn't do this or that. Like, he sets the stage and the path where she can elevate herself and get out there and become the star that both we, the viewer, and Komei know she can become.
I mean, it's got like a really great eye for like music as a collaborative medium. You know, Eiko is the star. Like, she is the one, like, you know, it wouldn't be anything without her talent, but also it's this understanding that, like, you know, especially with electronic music, it is like very much a product of a lot of people bringing their talents in together. You know, I think there's a way to go talk about that in a way that's negative about like, well, it's music by committee, but like, but I'm going to be positive, even though it's not my kind of music, and say like, you know, all these different people are bringing in their different contributions and putting it together and making it the sum of it more than the sum of its parts. And I really, you know, I enjoyed Aiko as a character a lot, but I think like also one of the big balancing acts that the show pulled off is making Kong, like pulling off Kong Ming as a character, because like, I know that he's from Romance of the Three Kingdoms. So like, there's kind of already this established, like he's, you know, the greatest strategist. He's like super, super smart. He learns things really fast, but like that would be so easy to like do in a really kind of lazy way, or like in a way that doesn't really, that makes it feel like everything is just too easy. But it just comes across as just like he is figuring things out as he goes, and he sees like where the puzzle pieces fall together. He sees where the strings are, and he's still like a really like fun, compelling character. And like, even though you know that he's gonna figure it out, like you don't know how he's gonna figure it out and how to make it work. And yeah, no, he's just so much fun and just like great voice work. Also, like shout out to the translator Jake Jung for like making all the work. Absolutely all incredible that rap work. Stuff. I saw on his Twitter he's currently recovering from COVID. Get well soon, Jake. Dude.
Feel better.
Yeah.
great work.
You know, like he did like absolutely incredible work on it. You know, translating lyrics is difficult. At the best of times, like that's why most anime don't even bother. And he had to do multiple rap battles in a simulcast time frame, and he just nailed it. Everyone involved with this nailed it, because like EDM, and I think it's EDM, right? I'm saying the right genre, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I really don't know anything about electronic music, but like, you know, anime is a collaborative medium. It takes so many people bringing it together to make it work. So many people came together and made this one work when by all rights, it shouldn't have.
Guys, go watch Kong Ming. I'm just realizing that we are actually hyping a lot of high dive shows.
Oh, really?
I've been saying for a while that people need to re-up their high dive subscriptions. I've got a lot of great stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if more people subscribe to their app, they might be able to afford some more technicians to work on the app, which would be great.
It's so broken. I'm sorry.
Like, that's,
I can't
the
remember
one thing.
What episode I'm on.
Yeah.
Of anything. Like.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think that brings us to our number ones, excluding me, because mine was Chainsaw Man, and we already talked about it. But yeah, we're going to start with Richard here, and your number one, it is on a couple other people's lists, although not in this chat. Yeah. And I feel like maybe I missed out on this one as well, but this is Call of the Night.
Yeah.
Which is the sexy vampire insomniac show, if I remember right.
I mean, I don't think I would actually call it that in any way, shape, or form.
Which word would you take out? Because it is a vampire show and the kid is an insomniac, right?
I would actually take out the sexy,
because
that's not really what it's about. Like, she does dress in the costume you see her
in. Oh, well, I said sexy because I saw screenshots of the biting, and it was, you know, but maybe that was from the first episode.
Yeah, I mean, it does do that sometimes, but it, yeah. I mean, that's vampire stuff.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
So it's like the baseline level of sexy for any good vampire fiction.
Yeah. Honestly, yeah, pretty much. But basically, like, yeah, if you really want to get down to it, it's about the fact that humans were creatures of routine, right? Mm-hmm. We can do even exciting things or horrible things become boring and normal if you do them enough. And really the human experience, I mean, the reason we all watch anime in the first place is because we seek novelty. We seek something new that challenges us or engages us in a way that we've never been challenged or engaged before. And what we have in this story is basically a middle school kid who lives up to all the expectations placed upon him, and he has no happiness from doing that. He goes to school every day, he says the right things, he studies the right things, and he gets nothing from it. And so one day he just stops going to school. And one night he just wanders out and sees that the night is, you know, the early AM is a very different world from like our world. And yes, we have, you know, the vampire side of it, but that's not the thing that they're exploring. That's not the novelty that hooks him, right? It's, you know, meeting people on the street and just randomly talking with them, you know, helping out a drunk person get home, or a woman who's worked, you know, till 3 a.m. for her slave driver boss and just kind of needs a friend to talk to. Like, those are the kind of people that our middle school protagonist and our vampire protagonist meet on their like nightly adventures. And it's basically about how, you know, he's trying, like, they're both trying to find this new novelty, and she finds her the new novelty by showing him the world of the night, and he gives her novelty by experiencing it for the first time. Mm. And so they kind of, yeah, they have this kind of symbiotic relationship. And through that, they're able to like re-examine what they want in life and basically kind of come to terms with what is love? What is the concept of love? And neither of them understand.
Thank you, Caitlin. I appreciate you doing that because I was about to respond.
Yeah.
Is everything okay? What are you guys whispering about? What are you and Caitlin whispering about?
Nothing.
What? Do I get to know after the show?
Yeah.
It's really nice. Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah, we got like some secret like note passing going on.
I just don't want to interrupt. I said, baby, don't hurt me.
Yes, yes. Because what is
it? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. But yeah, it's very funny and cute because like, yeah, she's a vampire of indeterminate age and he's a middle school kid and neither of them understand love. But he decides that like this nightlife is so much better than the daylife that he wants to become a vampire. And the twist is you have to fall in love with a vampire. And then when the vampire bites you, then you will become a vampire. But if there's no love, you don't become one. And so it's kind of this thing where she really has no interest in making a minion. And, but at the same time, they're kind of enjoying their life in the night together. And then somehow in this, yeah, it's all their little kind of one-off adventures in the night, the people, the friends they meet, the new people they meet. And every once in a while, it has an amazing action scene that just blows you away. But it's, you know, we've all been, you know, that kid that who doesn't know, like, why am I at this school? Why am I doing all these things? What is the purpose to my life? Yeah. And then he finds it in the weirdest of places. And it's surprisingly profound.
I also heard there's like a hot lady with glasses who's a mess that shows up later. Steve tells me about these things.
Oh no. Yeah. If the show at this point has an antagonist, it's her.
Oh, okay.
It's a vampire hunting detective.
Oh, okay.
Who has had a very vastly different relationship with vampires than our main character, who is basically like his best friend is this vampire girl, basically.
Yeah.
And it's kind of this thing of like, are either of them wrong in their viewpoints? Because they're all both based on personal experiences. And like, what does that mean? And how do their viewpoints clash? And like, she's set up very much as like, if there's a second season, she's the big bad, like the detective is. But at the same time, you know, she sits down the main character and is like, so you know that like being a vampire really sucks, right? Like kind of things.
Yeah.
And like, you know that like, you know, they do terrible things to people, right? You know, kind of thing. And
it sounds like an anime version of The Only Lovers Left Alive that Tom Hiddleston and oh my gosh.
Wait, is there a movie that exists where Tom Hiddleston plays a vampire?
Yeah, it's Tom Hiddleston and
I've never heard of this.
To watch this.
Oh, what is your name?
So mad that I haven't watched this.
Androgynous Ice Queen.
Tilda Swinton.
Yeah, Tilda Swinton and Tom Hiddleston play vampires.
No, you got me at Androgynous. It's Tilda Swinton.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it's very much the same thing where like they're vampires, but it's much more about like them exploring the world together, you know, and different dynamic because they're not middle schoolers, but yeah, right. That's really cool. That really makes
sense. No, I hope Tom Hiddleston also plays a middle schooler.
And then I have to say though, I did want to mention though, that this is by the person who did, what was it? The Dagashi show.
Yeah. The one about candy.
About candy. Yeah. And I did not like that show.
Yeah.
I did not like it. I just want to say that, but I did not like it, but I really, really like The Call of the Night, obviously. They're very, like, if you like the conversations in that show, then you'll probably like the conversations in Call of the Night. That's where the connection is. So it's absolutely the best part about that show, that manga, in this one. And yeah, watch it, like, maybe if you give it a 2-episode watch, you'll know kind of what to expect from it. And it's just, you know, it's about finding that joy in your life, that one thing that always stays novel, that, you know, keeps you going through life. So
this next one is AJ's number one, and I am surprised that this is also the only time that this anime shows up. We've really just had a good year, I think. So, yeah, but I think most of us watched Kaguya-sama, right?
Like, yes!
Yes!
Mm-hmm. I agonized over not putting this on my list.
Me too.
Because it deserves a spot. Well, this year's just too good.
Just didn't quite make it. Although, you know, there's no way that I won't continue watching it as soon as the movie becomes available. AJ, why is Kaguya your number one?
Funny enough, it's probably for the same reasons that a lot of us liked Chainsaw Man.
Yeah.
Because it's so interesting seeing an adaptation take already really well-written material and then put their own twist on it, add to it, expand upon it. This definitely wasn't the funniest season. I think season 2 is probably the funniest season of the three. Yeah. But
I don't know, that rap battle, man.
I wrote in my thing, this had to go in the top 5 for that rap episode alone.
Yeah.
Because of how good that was. That was, I liked it more for its creativity than just the pure
humor. Didn't that also happen the same week as the Ya Boy Kong Ming rap battle?
Yeah, I think they were like the same week.
It was a week for rap battles.
That was a joke that was going around.
Wasn't that also that same episode that had the new ED, like the alternate, like the...
They made a special rap ED.
Oh, yes,
for
yes.
The episode. Why the hell is it reanimated?
Oh, that's right. There was another rap battle episode that week, too. Thank you, Nick. Yeah. Aharon had one that week.
Oh, wow. 3 rap battles in a week.
So it's... But see, that's what I mean. There's just so much this show is so extra.
Yeah.
And I did not like this show at first when it aired. I was the contrarian at that point that, it's kind of overhyped. Oh, I don't really like Kaguya as a character. But I committed to it in some ways because I had to. And I feel like... Well, okay, you made me review season 3. I watched season 1 and 2 because I did a video for it for the channel. Because I wanted to talk about the localization and everything. But by the time I got to season 2, I was on board. And that's why I'm glad that you let me review season 3. Season 3 feels like the payoff for my commitment to this show. Like, okay, we're going to go back and reference everything. We are going to justify the gimmick of this show. We're going to go... Some of these characters are pretty terrible. We're going to go into why, and they're going to recognize that, reflect on it, and grow from it. And it's going to tie into real world insecurities that you might be going through right now, like not feeling worthy enough or not feeling like you deserve to be loved by somebody else or feeling tormented by your family circumstances. It's like, damn. And when we got to the ending, when those last couple of episodes crescendoed to the thing that we were all waiting for, I didn't cry or anything, but I didn't to like get up and walk around the room because I was just so overwhelmed with emotion. And that's what I mean. There was a lot of stuff, great stuff this year. A lot of funny stuff, mm-hmm. a lot of action-packed stuff. So I focused on the shows that made me feel something, and nothing this year made me feel intense emotions the way that this finale did. I cannot wait for the movie. I can't wait for like the two or three seasons that are probably going to come after that movie. I already finished the manga when it ended, and it's just, oof. There is a reason why this is probably going to go down as one of the most popular and well-known romantic comedies of like the past decade.
You think it's gonna be the new Toradora?
Ha 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 ha. Toradora will always have a place in my heart, but if Toradora was not there, then the show would probably take its place.
Yeah.
It's definitely in my top 10 anime.
One of my favorite gags from this season is specifically the Resident Evil gag where they're doing the haunted house and Kaguya, and all, there's just a short bit where you can tell by the way they're making her walk that it's
like the tank controls in the OG game. Yeah. I have those old games, so that was a deep cut for me. Yeah. But see, that's what I mean. Like, none of that stuff is in the manga at all. Like,
you can tell the animators are just like having so much fun coming up with mm-hmm. the wildest things they can include in any given joke. Like, what can we add to this thing to make it 1,000% more extra than it already was?
Exactly. And that's why I love it. It's not a straight adaptation, but everything is in service to the stuff that was already there.
Yeah, no, I've been a fan of this director since Showa Genroku Rakugo Shinju, which if you haven't watched
it, I didn't know that was
it was the same director.
The same director. Which
everything makes sense.
If y'all have not watched that show, you should watch it. Mm-hmm. And also like demand a Blu-ray of it because I'm dying here, y'all.
Yeah. Across the universe, so maybe it's next. Maybe.
Yeah, but it's been so fun just like watching him letting his staff like just go completely wild with the animation, because that's like been there since the first season. Like the 20 questions, like the gun, it being a gunfight was completely invented for the anime. Like in the manga, it was just them playing 20 questions. Yeah. And I feel like it has only gotten wilder as the series has gone. And it's just amazing.
James,
all of the animators are just okay. All the animators are just like, oh, no one's told us no yet. So
I operate my entire editorial section. No one's told me no yet.
I have a very strange love-hate relationship with Kaguya in general. I finally figured it out though. I don't ever want to watch it week to week. Okay. I always start and make that mistake and I drop off, because what I care about is their relationship moving forward. But it's always the first half to three-fourths of each season that is lots of one-off jokes. And don't get me wrong, they're all important. They all come back for those final few episodes each time. But like for me watching week to week, I get really bored and I dislike it. When I marathon it, I have a blast. Oh. That's what I found out this time.
Yeah.
I just... Basically, I think I like it when stuff actually happens in their relationship. So I tend to like the last like four or five episodes of each season. I'm always afraid with series like this that we're in an eternal holding pattern, that we're never really going to get progress. The progress we always get is kind of like fake progress that they're going to rewind.
That happens in a lot of rom-coms in general. But
that's not what happened. Yeah. And it's actually very funny. I looked at the viewer numbers week by week, like the Google Trend viewer numbers, like how popular something is. You can just look on Google Trends. If you look at this last season, it's hilarious because it goes up constantly or stays the same, which means it's a pretty good show in general. And then that final episode airs and it quadruples in size.
Oh, wow.
Because something vital happened that changed the game and brought everybody back into it. I have seen the movie. I reviewed it obviously up on the site. And I'll have to say this, like it's more drama than comedy, which makes the last season better in retrospect. because there is like serious fallout to these actions and mm-hmm. having to deal with them, and spending this full movie basically on that in specific. And I'll say this though, it's almost character assassination for Kaguya, the movie.
Well, now I really want to watch it.
I know.
But that's and that's the good and the bad of it. Like, her worst side comes out.
Oh, right.
Her the worst part of her comes out. But like, that's important to know, like, you know, kind of accept that we all have that kind of crappy side of ourselves that sometimes comes out. And we don't have to like it. And we should battle against it. But at the same time, we also need to accept it, that it's there.
And if someone's going to love you, they're going to have to forgive you for it.
And that's exactly too. It. Yeah. Like,
that is the theme of the whole movie.
Yeah, and that is the theme of the movie. And it's
so it's Kaguya really Persona edition.
Actually, that's surprisingly apt. Like, you don't even know how correct you are.
Is it like, Kaguya-sama 3.0 plus 1.0?
You cannot.
Again, that's also relatively
apt. Yeah.
All right, this next one, Caitlin, this is your number one. And again, I think this is a unique pick for all the reviewers, including us here. Even though it's a great show, I watched it as well. This is The Executioner and Her Way of Life, another high dive show.
I also feel bad for not including this show because this show is really good.
Yeah,
it is really good.
And the best OP of the season, I think.
Yeah, no, the opening was definitely one of my front runners for best song. Didn't get it because Bochy eventually ran away with that one. But yeah, you know, this is one where it's really, really hard for me to quantify exactly like why I chose it as my number one. My top five list is vibes based. And honestly, if you ask me in a month, I might give you five completely different choices. But for the time being, right now, this was the one that jumped to my head for the top of my list. Because, and once again, we're coming back to that recurring theme. I really, really want shows with a primarily female cast that are not primarily about titty or cuteness, you know? And The Executioner and Her Way of Life has an entirely, like, female cast. And it is a show where things get weird and things get gross and things like get squishy in all manner of ways. And I love that about it. Like something that I said in the Annie Femme podcast about it that like some people decided to misinterpret me saying is that it feels like if you took the entire cast and you gender swapped them, made it entirely like an entirely male cast, it feels like things would not change significantly. And what I mean by that is that the writing is not heavily gendered. They are not softened because they are girls. They are not cutified because they are girls. And it's just such a compelling story. It takes, you know, a lot of the isekai tropes and turns them on their head. You know, it is what the TV tropes kids call a deconstruction, which is not what a deconstruction means in terms of literary theory. But it does like look like, hey, what if there was a world with a bunch of super powered teens coming from Japan all the time? And like, you get that sometimes with series where they make them kind of like fools to make fun of, like Fantasy Knockout. Which was another series that I really loved this year that didn't make the list. Like, you know, you have the Kirito clone and he's a complete idiot. But the answer that this series comes up with is things would be really fucking messed up.
Yeah.
You know, and so naturally there would be an organization to stop them. And naturally an organization to stop them would turn out some really fucked up people because you are assassins.
Yeah.
You know, you are here killing these teenagers who did nothing wrong, but, you know, inevitably something is going to happen. And then, but these inevitably, these teens are so powerful, there's going to be one that you just can't kill. And, you know, maybe it's not inevitable that she's gay and in love with you.
Or maybe it is.
But, you know, it's... but also, like, I'm not complaining about that part. You know, so it's got, like, really great character writing. The characters are, like, so much fun watching them play off of each other. Princess Ashuna is, like, so ripped. I love watching her, like... every like I love watching her just, you know, full stop, but also
life
like
goals
her yeah. Like, oh, yeah. Like her interactions with Momo are so much fun. Like, I love Flair as a villain. I hope the series gets more seasons. You know, I kind of want to cosplay as Flair, like, because she sucks so bad. She seems like she would be really fun to cosplay as.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a really, really fun series that takes a lot of concepts and puts a really unusual spin on them.
I agree 100%. I also liked the part when they finally did the reveal of, like, they had, like, all these tapestries, like, about the Japanese children coming into the world. And, like, it was all, like, medieval sort of style, prophetic-looking artwork. And it's like, and that's why we have to murder them, because they would destroy everything. And, I mean, people kind of lost their shit with the first episode, because she fakes out this boy who gets isekai'd there. And he was, like, an extra. There were, like, two of them. And they're like, oh, you were an accident. And they abandon him. And she finds him, like, under a bridge and takes him to town, and seems like she's showing his way of life, but his power is that he can just, like, make things disintegrate, I think, by saying, like, thinking what they
like
are.
The void. Like,
nullification.
Yeah. So she has to decapitate him in a church. Yeah. And
well, he also instantly goes,
slaps him.
Right. Finally, I'll make them all pay.
Yeah.
All those people that laughed at me. She's like,
we can't keep you around here. You're out for vengeance, and you've got too much power for a 15-year-old.
And in all fairness, like, it's not like they never have given these teens a chance. Like, there's been, what, like, 5 major world-destroying calamities because they gave people a chance.
Yeah, this is like a post-apocalyptic world.
Right, like, at this point, kill them all. Kill them all. Yeah. That's what you need to do, because your world is just screwed without it.
Yeah.
But what I really like about it, though, very simply, is often... a lot of shows are very predictable in where they're going to go. Now, it can be fun going there, but, like, you know where you're going. But this is one that just, what could the happy ending be? Like, it's so hopeless. That, like, it's so hopeless, but, like, at the same time, as Stephen King says about The Dark Tower, it's about the journey, not the ending, right? That's where the real value is found. That's really how I kind of feel about it. Like, I'm rooting for them, and I legitimately don't know how they're going to find a semblance of a happy ending, but I'll still watch and still root for them.
Yeah. All right. This is our last number one, which is good, because we've been almost going for 3 hours.
I have a lasagna to make.
We've got some time differences going on. Richard's lucky. It's the middle of the day for him, but the rest of us.
Easy.
It's getting a little late. So,
what, you want to do 5 more hours? Sure, yeah.
I will fight you. My back hurts so bad.
All right. This last one is James's final pick. And I might fight him about it, because we both watched this for the after show. And it's Made in Abyss Season 2. The Golden City of the Scorching Sun. Did I get that right? All right. I nailed it. All right. James, explain to me why the show with all the phallic creatures getting torn apart by black tentacles is your favorite show of the year.
You mean like a
Well, didn't you explain it?
Yeah. there are a couple reasons. One, Richard was just talking about how, you know, if we're going by Dark Tower rules, right? It's about the journey, not the destination. And I think, to me, Made in Abyss as a whole is kind of like the ultimate representation of that. where there we know for a fact there is no happy ending, because the only ending is a descent into the worst place imaginable where you will die horribly. But the show still manages to find so much beauty and so much power. Honestly, a huge reason that this show got number one for me, it's really personal. It's like AJ was saying, this year sucked a lot. I know that I lost some family members this year, and it's just generally been a not so fun 2022. And this show just kind of happened to coincide with a lot of that, where yes, it's disgusting, and yes, I can recommend it to absolutely nobody.
Yeah.
And I am constantly terrified that the author is going to be outed as some kind of actual criminal, which will
any day now.
A horrible, horrible day of reckoning. That I pray never comes. But I just, I don't know. I don't think, I struggle to name many other works of fiction that have so perfectly been what I needed them to be at a perfect time in my life, when I had no other way to, I guess, kind of come to terms with some of the emotions and some of the grief that I was feeling. And then it just so happens that there's this story that is literally all about how, even though the things that you love are destined to be lost one way or the other, at some point in your journey, even though the people that you love are destined to, you know, be taken from you or to be lost from you, or that, you know, you're going to be taken from them. All of those things are still a part of what makes your life valuable and what makes your time with them meaningful. And that's not like a new trope, you know, like pretty much any story about immortality is the same thing, right? Like, you know, life is precious because it's fleeting, and, you know, the things that, you know, you can't have a rainbow without the rain and all that stuff. But there's something about the way that Maiden Abyss uses its setting and its characters to push that concept about as far as you could or should go artistically, in order to make sure that you feel, like, in your guts exactly what the characters are feeling, you know, at the end of the season when they say that, you know, yeah, maybe life in the abyss is genuinely a nightmare that no one can wake up from, but maybe that's also what makes living through it so beautiful. The fact that we can, like, overcome it and survive it and find the beauty in it, even when it feels like there's nothing but, you know, bad toilets and bad chefs. So yeah, it's just, I think it is truly one of the most beautiful and profound kind of meditations on mortality and living in temporary meat sacks that I've ever seen. And it's just unfortunate that everything about it is so reprehensible and off-putting that I can't in good conscience tell anyone else to go watch it, even though I think it's a masterpiece. So,
all right. So not to, like, invalidate anything James just said. I mean, I enjoyed the show for the ride that it was, and it is definitely a ride. And I mean, I think James and I have also said on the In and After show when we were covering this that it is, you can't recommend it to, like, anybody, like, ever. Like, how do you even broach that? How do you even bring it up in conversation? You can't. So
these kids get strung up naked all the time, right?
And that's, yeah, the best case it's scenario. Just, there's weird fixation on putting things in the belly button, and limb loss.
How much pee?
There's a lot of pee, yep. I hook him up to a machine once and extract his pee in the movie. You know, there's all these sorts of things that you just sort of, even as, like Richard said earlier, you know, you get desensitized to certain things from anime, but you can't get desensitized to the things that they do in Made in the Abyss. So it's this really weird show in that, like, it has profound thoughts on grief and stuff. Everything James said is completely valid. I personally felt, I put this as my number 5, and I just saved it until we got to this point. And I put it there with Attack on Titan, because to me it was, I really enjoyed the first season a lot. The second season veered a little too much into
what the fuck for me, including yeah. all of the phallic villagers and the
baby eating.
Baby eating. Yep. That's in there. All kinds of stuff. That being said, this might be a good time to tell James that I did, in fact, buy you a villager from this show, and it should show up at your house in a couple months.
Oh my God. Wait, can I ask which one? And is it Ma?
It's Ma. Yeah, I got you a Ma.
My trash.
For anyone who hasn't watched it, it basically looks like a pink potato sack with dildo arms and a bare ass. And you're looking at that ass all the time in this show.
Constantly. And it will make you cry.
Ma redeems itself after squishing the rabbit creature until it had, what's the term for that?
Until it prolapses?
Prolapsed butthole.
I'm so sorry.
This is James's number one. This is what he picked instead of Kaguya-sama. On the record, just need everybody to know that.
I put it above Chainsaw Man.
It above Chainsaw Man.
Yeah.
It's okay. All right.
For my caveat, I will say I think as a production, as an anime, I think Chainsaw Man is the best anime that's come out all year.
Sure. I think it's too late, James, so we'll let you say it.
But I think Made in Abyss is my favorite. So that's my number one.
Yeah. It's okay. I only brought up all the really bad points. James brought up all the really good points. The rest of you can weigh them and
It is like half and half. The show is reprehensible. So
well, you say you bring up the you said you brought up the bad points, but you still put it as your number five, right?
So. I did. But I mean, once you go read the entry, you will see that it was with a lot of trepidation. I bring up cannibalism and all kinds of stuff in there. I was like,
it's number five with like 50.
Now, there are people out there for whom it was nothing but good points.
Yeah, that's true. It is definitely 100% for somebody. Just to get in the comments really quick, Shining Falcon, Lynzee, did the second half of Ranking of Kings make the top five for you? I felt like that was cheating. Ranking of Kings was my number one last year. And so I just took that as a sign that I don't have to double dip, so I didn't. People who stuck it out, we'd love to see your top fives, or if you are watching this after we've all gone to sleep, leave them in the comments, because I want to see those, and you can compare them with the best of 2022 feature that'll be publishing on ANN. First part went up today, next one will be tomorrow, and then more after that, and then more after that and that. And there's a poll running right now where you can pick your top 10, and we'll publish the results of best 2022, worst 2022 anime, as well as best movies. So we've got that all up on the website. Go take a look. I want to thank everybody for coming out for this 3-hour anime love fest. We talked about all the good things and James's favorite. So... Hey.
At least I didn't pick like Lucifer and the Biscuit Hammers.
Yeah.
If we want to talk about watching ugly things on purpose.
Hey, where's Mike Dupree? Why is everything orange?
Isn't there like a really sad looking horse in that show too?
This is the most baffling looking show I've seen in a long time. Yeah. Truly.
All right, everybody. Thanks again for coming out. I had a great time. Thanks, James, AJ, Caitlin, Richard. We'll see most of you for the preview guide in a couple days.
Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year.
We get a rest for a couple days, then we're back.
Oh, y'all, you don't understand how hard the preview guide is. Grueling. Oh. Grueling.
Mm-hmm. I'm in complete denial.
Happy 2023, everybody!
Happy 2023! Watch some good anime!
Woo!